This is a production of SDPB.
Touchdown! This is for a state championship. Oh, direct kick, and it's good!
There's going to be some highlights coming off of this.
The short-range jumper.
Edging out in late for the top seed.
This South Dakota High School State Championship event is conducted under the direction of the South Dakota High School Activities Association.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. We're getting ready for 3 days of basketball action. It's the girls' AA basketball tournament on SDPB3. Along with Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toome. We are courtside here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, and it is going to be a great 3 days of basketball here. Tony, this is the first time we're working together. Why don't you tell the people who you are?
Well, I am Tony Schmidt. I am from Mitchell originally, I'm from Mitchell, and yes, I played basketball for Miller High School, and then I went on to play at Northern, and I'm just here excited to watch some basketball this weekend. So,
and we should have some great action coming up here today. Let's take a look at the schedule that we've got coming up here for today. This is day one. Our first game will feature O'Gorman taking on Rapid City Stevens, and then our second game of the afternoon session will be the Jefferson Cavaliers taking on the Pierre TF Riggs Lady Govs. Let's move on to the night session. We'll start at 6 o'clock Central, Harrisburg taking on Mitchell, and then the nightcap will be Spearfish playing Brandon Valley. That's our schedule for today here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Let's look at the teams participating in this first matchup of the day. We've got the unranked Rapid City Stevens Raiders. They weren't in the final poll, taking on the number one ranked O'Gorman. For Rapid City Stevens, Adam Dannenbring is their head coach. They average 51.5 points per game. They give up 44.5 on defense. 43% is what they shoot from the floor, 69.5% from the free throw line, and a 29% team from beyond the three-point arc. They are 13-8 coming into today's tournament as they beat Rapid City Central, their crosstown rival, 56-39. That was in the SODAC 16 round to force this matchup with O'Gorman. Here's the starting lineup: Brittany Jones, Talia Porter, who has a chance maybe to pass Becky Hammond next year as the all-time leading scorer in their school's history. She is a junior. Finley Love, Isabel Higgins, Isabel one of the team captains, and then Hallie Peterson, she is a sophomore. That's the starting lineup for the Raiders, the number 8 seed. They will be opposed by the unbeaten number one ranked O'Gorman Lady Knights. Kent Colson, 15 straight years the Lady Knights have been at the tournament. And I tell you what, Tony, this team is just flat out dynamite.
Yes, they are. They are an excellent defensive team, always causing trouble for any offense that's thrown at them.
Roosevelt was their victim in the SODAC 16 round, 65-31, and that forced this matchup against Stevens. These teams did meet during the regular season. That was back on February the 2nd, 47-35. It was the O'Gorman Knights winning that basketball game. And I believe, you talk about defense for O'Gorman, that's definitely one of their keys as well. Look at their lineup here. Lucy Moore, she's a Northern State commit. She is a senior guard along with Molly Abdush. What a player, 5'8 and a senior, and she can do everything. Number 2 all-time scorer, number 1 in steals all-time for O'Gorman. Sydney Turveen, Julia Eggert, and Wayne McCoy round out the starting lineup, and there you see the team stats. O'Gorman scores 58.5 points per game. They only give up 30 points per game. That means their average margin of victory, Tony, is 28 points per game. That's insane, boys or girls high school basketball.
True, very true.
The O'Gorman Knights, Lady Knights, 3 titles. Rapid City Stevens has never claimed a state AA title. Well, this is the first of 4 games we're going to have here today on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Bridgewater Emory Ethan is our high school band of the day, and in a few moments, they will be introduced along with our officials and the cheerleaders and performers for today's lineup. Good morning to everybody out West River cheering on the Raiders. Good afternoon to everybody cheering on the Knights here on the east side of the state. I'm Steve Toom along with Tony Schmidt. Let's turn it over to our public address announcer for our pregame ceremonies.
Good afternoon. The South Dakota High School Activities Association welcomes you to this opening session of the State Girls High School Basketball Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activities Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you'll enjoy the games and support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. Our first game features the Raiders of Stevens and the Lady Knights of O'Gorman. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please stand as we honor America with the playing of our national anthem. Today, the national anthem will be played by the Bridgewater Emory High School Pep Band. Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem. And now, let's meet the cheerleaders for today's game. First, the Raiders of Stevens. Grace Antonson. Matea Dubray. Taylor Larson. Olivia Roberts. Lexi Soesby. Annika Steele. Kate Terry and JC Thompson. Cheer supervisors Jamie Exner and Jennifer Agana. Now let's meet the cheer team for the Lady Knights of O'Gorman. Ella Adamack. Bryceland Barch. Carly Dumdye. Peyton Heitkamp, Maddie Honnerman, Diana Reyes, Sarah Richardson, and Josie Stewart. Karen Dumdye.
Time. It represents the past, the present, and the future, all at the same time. When you hear that it's state tournament time, what do you think about? Do you think about moments in the past? Maybe you think about one of the previous state championship teams. Or maybe it was the time your team came up just short and you can't shake it from your memory. When you hear it's state tournament time, do you think about the present? Do you think about the Rapid City Stevens Raiders? Or do you think about the Sioux Falls O'Gorman Knights? Or maybe when you hear it's state tournament time, your mind goes to the future. And time will tell who is left standing and celebrating with this trophy and leaving with these nets. Time can represent many things, but this moment right here, this is your time.
And now let's meet the starters for today's games in alternating fashion. For the Raiders at guard, a 5'6" junior number one, Brittany Jones. For the Lady Knights, at guard, a 5'7" senior, number 11, Lucy Moore. For the Raiders, at guard, a 5'8" junior, number 3, Talia Porter. For the Lady Knights, at guard, a 5'8" senior, number 15, Molly Abdouche. For the Raiders, at guard, a 5'5" sophomore, number 11, Finley Love. For the Lady Knights, at guard, a 5'10" sophomore, number 30, Sydney Turveen. For the Raiders, at forward, a 5'9" senior, number 20, Isabel Higgins. For the Lady Knights, at forward, a 5'10" junior, number 31, Julia Eggert. For the Raiders, at guard, a 5'6" sophomore, number 23, Hallie Peterson. For the Lady Knights, at center, a 6'2" senior, number 35, Awang Okoy. The Raiders are led by Adam Denenbrink, assistant coaches Tanner Wagg, Quintel Porter, Seth Eade, and Gerald Johnson. The Lady Knights are led by Kent Coldrew, assistant coaches Barry Mathis, Crystal Richter, Dan Hughes, and Kristen Rydell. Your officials for this game, Brian Wedham, Rusty Keith, and Kim Zimmerman.
First matchup, the Raiders of Rapid City, Stevens, the O'Gorman Lady Knights. O'Gorman in the home whites, the road blue for the Raiders, and the tip controlled by Abdouche. And the Knights will have the basketball first. Oh, Aaron pass, and who's got it? It's gonna be Porter. And we may have a jump ball, and we will. Tony, quick keys to the game for both squads. What do you see first for the Raiders, what they have to do today?
You know, they really need to take care of the ball, and they have to get some outside shots to fall. With 29%, they're going to need those outside shots to fall in order to stay in this. O'Gorman is just crazy athletic, crazy long and lengthy, and they just pressure all over the court.
That's why they hold their opponents to just 30 points per game. There's a shot up from the free throw line, bounces around, and the iron is kind for Brittany Jones, and the first points go to the Raiders. And now some full court pressure. Looks like the Raiders will chase all the way down the court as the Knights work it to the corner. Moore runs the show. She's going to Northern State to play basketball. Abdouche going to South Dakota State. Off the window, too strong, and the rebound pulled down by Peterson. Raiders on the move. Ooh. Contact, ball slapped out of bounds. It'll go to the Raiders. Could have been an offensive foul.
Could have been. It was a strong move to the basket, but I don't think she was quite planted, so.
Of course, he had that forearm out there too. Referees are watching for that. It'll go to the corner and Hallie Peterson. Oh, we're gonna have a foul, and it's gonna be on Moore. And it will be Jones, the junior, to trigger it in. She averages 5.5 points per game. Quick three from the corner, in and out.
Oh, we might have another jump ball. Look out as players hit the deck. And the alternating possession to the Lady Knights. Well, the iron was kind on the first shot, not on the second shot there for the Raiders. Set three was put up from the corner by Finley Love. Pressure from the Raiders. Abduch goes down low to McCoy. Nice pass.
Very nice. Molly just sees the court so well.
Trouble getting it in for the Raiders. Now that's going to be Peterson trapped in the corner. Gets it back to Jones up ahead. Here's Love with the ball. She's cut off from the basket. They'll kick it back outside to Jones. She'll run the show. Takes a shot, but it was blocked. It ends up in the hands of Peterson. Raiders keep it with 20 on the shot clock. Here's a drive off balance. Good for Higgins. Higgins committed to Black Hills State for track and field. It's 4-2 Raiders early on. Shot from the outside there for Eggert. And the pass stolen away by the Raiders. And they find Porter. Porter hasn't touched the ball much, and the Raiders are up 4-2. Pressured by Moore. In the corner, nice fake by Jones. That shot might have been partially blocked. Ends up in the hands of the Lady Knights. Moore on the move. There's a drive by Tervine. Yes. Tied up at four as we approach the 5-minute mark here in quarter number one. Outlet and a bucket for the Raiders. That's Higgins. She's got four. You like the way that Stephen's spacing the court on that pressure?
Yes, and seeing the whole court, pushing it down the court before O'Gorman has a chance to get set into their defense.
Moore lost the handle momentarily. Eggert on the outside, gives way to Moore. Gorman has the height advantage in this matchup. Moore nearly lost it. Eight on the shot clock. Spin, and we're gonna have a whistle. Traveling is the call. Timeout on the court. O'Gorman and Stevens doing battle. It's the Raiders up 6-4. We'll be back after this timeout on SDPB 3.
As much as you have accomplished, there are times you'd rather not go it alone. While you determine what direction you go, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with community. Go with neighbors. Go with understanding. Go with support.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Along with Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toome. We are live at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, day one of the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on SDPB3. Tony, what do you see so far from both teams that they're doing well and what they need to improve on?
Well, I think Stevens is doing a great job. They're playing straight man defense on them and I feel like they're keeping the pressure on them. They're pushing the ball up the court offensively.
Here's a three-on-one, but a nice steal by the Knights, and I think the player stepped out of bounds for O'Gorman indeed. That was Ruby Moore, 5'8 freshman who just checked in. Younger sister of Lucy Moore. But Raiders had a three-on-one opportunity there.
Yes, they're being aggressive on offense and not waiting for them to catch up.
Here's a shot. Good, it's a three. Finley Rowe. crashes in from downtown. And just like that, 9-4, Raiders on top, and they go to the full court pressure. O'Gorman goes to the bench with Peyton Peterson. She is a senior at 5'6", wearing number 10. Abdush will now handle. Little give and go with Okoye. It's taken away from her. Scramble for the ball. Still nobody's got it. Somebody kicked it. It was one of the O'Gorman players. It goes to the Raiders. Owing Okoye, 6'2 senior. She's headed to Southwest Minnesota State to play basketball. But a misfire on the inbounds play, and the Raiders turn it over and give it back to O'Gorman. Pressure pays off that time for the Lady Knights. That's just the kind of mistake you can't make if you're the Raiders. You're up 9-4, but O'Gorman's got the firepower to erase any deficit. McCoy working hard off the window. Nice shot. McCoy has 4 points. 9-6 Raiders, and the Raiders break the pressure again. Porter's going to handle now. She'll call out the play. She'll put up the mid-range jumper just off the mark. Okoye has a handle on it. Gives way to Abdush. She wants to run. Cut off from the basket. Ooh, near travel. But a shot put up, and it's short. And that will go out of bounds. It goes to the Raiders. On the miss there was Ruby Moore. She averages 5.3 points a game. Higgins checking in to give Peterson a break for the Raiders. Raiders going to the bench, and Jessa Griswold, number 13, a 5'6 sophomore, triggers in, gets it to Finley Love. Pressure in the backcourt. Here comes that double team. Pass is tipped into the hands of O'Gorman, and a foul in the backcourt. And that'll be a foul on the Raiders and on Griswold. And if I miss my mark, I think that's our first foul of the game. And check that. Gorman has a foul. One team foul for both squads. Pushing foul on the Raiders. That's Griswold quickly. She picks up her second foul. And it looks like she's going to go to the bench in favor of Finley Love, number 11, in for the Raiders. Douche wants the inbounds, but they'll go to the corner instead to Peterson, the Lady Knights. Oh, denied. Ball's loose in the middle of the floor. Picked up by Love. Good defense by the Raiders. See if they can cash in on the other end. Here's a drive. Shot short. Tipped around. Who's it out on? I think it's going to go to the Raiders. Nope, it's going. Oh, there's some confusion. Players, both teams walking down court. It'll stay with Stevens. The full shot clock to work with. Into the post. Porter surrounded. Puts it up off balance. Is hurt. That's her first points. She averages 19.7 points and 6 rebounds a game. Here come the Knights quickly. The shot, no good. Out of bounds off O'Gorman. It'll go to the Raiders. What a start here for Rapid City Stevens. 11-6 the score. O'Gorman, the number one team, unbeaten on the year. They're trailing early on. And there's a steal. Moore read it perfectly. And a foul, blocking foul. That'll be on Finley Love, and that's her first. And that play happened right in front of us, Tony. You could just see Moore's eyes read that one all the way. Hits, check out the replay here.
Yep, she was zoned in on that one. But in talking with head coach Adam Dannenbring yesterday, one of the key points he mentioned is that they have to take care of the ball. They have to, you know, limit their turnovers. I think the last time they matched up with O'Gorman, O'Gorman forced 20 turnovers on them. So he was thinking that was a key to their success today.
Right now it's 11-8 in favor of the Raiders. They'll break the pressure again. Down court, layup no good. Rebound to the Raiders, they'll throw it to the outside, and Finley Love will set on the miss there by Tamaya Poorbear. He transferred in from Kadoka to Rapid City Stevens. Bounce pass stolen by the Lady Knights. Moore takes the three, no. Long rebound secured by the Raiders. But, oh, I think the player stepped out of bounds. Yep, that was Jones. She got the rebound, but her momentum took her out of bounds. Turnover there for the Raiders. I think Jones might have been better letting that one just roll out of bounds. Just a three-point advantage for the Raiders. They've played very strong here in this early going. Player lost the ball, got it back. Off the window, no good. Look out. We're going to have a foul, and that's going to be on Porter, and that's her first, team's fourth. Foul starting to rack up now on Stevens. And remember, there's the new rules now. It's five fouls per quarter, then you get the double bonus. It resets at the end of every quarter. Overtime is the exception. Moore, left-handed, no. Rebound, Porter, she wants to run. The Knights are back on defense. Under a minute to go. High post, it's Poorbear, down low. Higgins is open and scores. Six for Isabel Higgins, the senior.
Knights just got caught out of position there and paid for it.
And here's a steal. Good hands by Poorbear. Ends up in the midst of Porter. Now the high post. Spins. Left-hand shot. Partially blocked. Out of bounds. No. Saved by the Raiders. They still got 20 on the shot clock. It didn't reset. Porter's going to take her time. 5 seconds difference between shot clock and game clock. Here as we wind down quarter number one. Porter put it up, and we're going to have a foul on Poorbear. I think she was trying to draw the foul there. It did not happen. But that's the fifth team foul. And I believe we have free throws. Yep, we will walk down to the other end of the court for the double bonus for the final 10 seconds of the quarter. So five fouls against the Raiders, just one against the Lady Knights. Moore at the line is an 81% free throw shooter. The first. Here's a sub in, Okoye. She will replace number 24. That is Ruby Moore. So a little more height than the lineup now for the final 10 seconds for the Lady Knights. That one will not fall. Higgins clears the rebound. Time for the Raiders. If they hurry, they'll go to the corner. A three's on the way. No good. Rebound Lady Knights. And that's how the first quarter will end. Raiders 13, Lady Knights 8. Back with more of the Girls AA Basketball Tournament, SDPB3.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
At BankWest, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. BankWest.
Welcome back to Heritage Court inside the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, day one of the Curls AA basketball tournament here on SDPB3. Along with Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toon. There you see some of the fans having fun here at this wonderful facility in Sioux Falls. As we check the stats here at the end of the quarter, turnovers was something you mentioned, Tony, and it turns out O'Gorman's got twice as many as the Raiders after one quarter, 8-4.
Yeah, not expected for sure. I think O'Gorman seems just a little off their game. They got to settle into their, do what they've been doing all year, which is making people uncomfortable the entire length of the court and just being patient on offense. They have so many threats.
Oh, nearly had a jump ball there, but the Raiders keep it. They have Mackenzie Schreiber, number 25, into the game. She's handling the ball there, gives it to Porter up top. Looks like the Lady Knights have gone to a zone. Three is good. Schreiber, her first points. That's a big boost and a near turnover in the backcourt. I'll tell you what, one of those bench players, all it takes is them to hit a couple of shots is Molly Abdouche, believe it or not, that's her first points of the game. Pressure again, 16-11, and there's a foul at midcourt, and that will be on Abdouche, and that is her first. And the team fouls reset at every quarter break. The Knights packing it into, it looks like, a 2-3 zone. Higgins had an opening off balance, and bailing her out there was number 23, Peterson. Porter's three off the mark. Lucy Moore grabs the rebound, pressured in the backcourt, trying to get away from Jones, and will give away to Molly Abdouche. Molly committed to South Dakota State. And here's a drive by Moore, too strong, and Porter with the rebound. Has a player ahead of everybody, but can't get it to her. Schreiber on the move. Oh, dangerous pass, and there's the steals leader, Abdouche. She'll get an easy one, give her four. And that's what you're talking about defensively for O'Gorman.
Yes, always, they're always there. Every time you turn around, full court even. Molly's so quick.
Yep, she's the all-time steals leader in O'Gorman girls basketball history. Here's a three, it's partially blocked into the hands of the Lady Knights. Terveen with the ball, weaving through traffic, bounce pass, shot, good. That's Eggert, her first points, and just like that, the Raiders' lead has evaporated one, and Adam Dannenbring wants to call a timeout to settle things down, and that's what we're talking about with O'Gorman. Doesn't matter how far they fall behind, with their defense, they can force turnovers and cut into a deficit just like that.
Absolutely. Another key point is second shots, getting a second shot on the rebound. Stevens has been pushing the ball up to, you know, half the time maybe they've needed to set up an offense because they're pushing the ball forward. And Adam mentioned yesterday too, getting the rebound, being there to get second shots is going to be key for them.
Take a look at the Knights huddle there. That's Kent Colesrud, a veteran coach, one of those guys, been there, done that, won state championships, has sent many players on to the next level at the helm of O'Gorman. And right now his team's down by one. Stevens has been scrappy. They've had a couple turnovers here lately, and it's cost them. And that's O'Gorman's game plan. O'Gorman, if they force turnovers, they're going to make you pay. There's a shot that's blocked, and Moore ends up with the loose ball. Outlet, Abdouche. Nice finish. She's got six.
Very nice. Pushing the floor.
Bounce pass, dangerous, into the hands of the Lady Knights. And now the Raiders, who were playing so good as far as taking care of the basketball here in the last few minutes, turned it over, and there's a drive and a shot, no good, by Eggert. Outlet, here come the Raiders on the move. They've been playing a little out of control as of late. Porter with the drive, in traffic, off the window!
Nice shot.
That's old school. Use the window high off the glass. Ah, the lost art of the jumper off the window. Oh, look out. Oh, players hitting the deck there, inadvertent. And good sportsmanship by Finley Love to go over and tell Moore, hey, my bad. And we've got a timeout on the court. 4:51 left, second quarter. Stevens on top 18-17, back in 1 minute here on SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other, lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
We are back at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Second quarter, 18-17. The Raiders on top of the Lady Knights. Along with Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toon. Great to have you along for the ride here as we're at 12:36 in the afternoon. Good morning to everyone out in the western part of the state. Here we got a few people, quite a few people watching the Raiders here as they're clinging on to that 1-point lead. They're the 8 seed, the Lady Knights the 1 seed in this tournament. The Lady Knights with the ball out of the timeout. Abdush is double teamed. Oh, stretches out, nearly traveled, but kept that pivot foot down. Here's a drive and a shot. It's up and in by Tervine. She's got 4. And the Lady Knights have the lead. It's their first lead of the game. Along the baseline there, Corbear got tied up outside. Porter's going to reset with 15 on the shot clock. Drive, steps through, too strong off the window, but tipped outside to Jones. Never hit the backboard. That's going to be an air ball. Porter, and they're going to say play on. Everybody stopped.
Everybody stopped.
But the shot did hit the bottom of the rim before the shot clock went off, so it's keep playing. Everybody's a little confused there on both teams. Tipped away into the hands of Jones. Outlet. Ahead of the crowd, the lefty layup too strong off balance, but some free throws coming up as Griswold hit the deck after she missed the shot. Moore's going to pick up her second foul for the Lady Knights. There's Griswold on the run out, kind of got a little out of position, tried the left-hand layup, but she was pushed. And Griswold to the line, 50% on the year as a free throw shooter. No good on the first. Two subs for each team. Higgins in, along with Jones for the Raiders.
Stevens is just being really aggressive on that last possession. Hallie Peterson coming around the front, forced the steal to give her team the fast break.
Pressure in the backcourt, and maybe if you're the Raiders, you got to take some of those chances, overplay the passing lanes, take a chance, get a hand on the ball, try to deflect it. Abdush handles the rock, goes to the high post. That's Egger. No. Rebound. Nothing but blue jerseys there. Corbear clears it away. Good defense by the Raiders. And I'm wondering, Tony, you think that zone defense has really caused some confusion for the Raiders offensively? Because the Lady Knights were man-to-man the first quarter.
I think they were sitting in zone for quite a bit of that first quarter. Their 2-3 zone is like... very well known. very effective.
There's a long shot. It almost went in with the shot clock winding down. Think of the 2-3 zone, you think Jim Boeheim at Syracuse. They were the masters at that 2-3 zone. Been adopted all over the college game. Here's a drive. Shut off was Peyton Peterson. Blocked up, no good, foul on the Raiders. Poirbert gets her second. So we look at the action underneath. Get a little physical now. Eggert to the line on the air, 59% at the free throw line. Makes the first of two. Eggert, 5'10 junior, 8.5 points, nearly 6 rebounds per game.
Yeah, I feel like she plays taller than 5'10. She's an excellent rebounder. She sneaks her way in to the paint, kind of a quiet threat for O'Gorman.
And the good teams always have those kind of players. They may average 7 or 8 points. We got double dribble called on the Raiders. Getting back to that point there. The good teams, whether boys or girls basketball, they're going to have 2-3 players maybe average 8 or 9, but they can explode for 15 to 20 on any given night. And that's what makes those great teams so dangerous.
Yeah, and O'Gorman, I mean, their depth is a big asset for them.
There's a three. It's up and good by Peyton Peterson, the senior. 23% shooter from beyond the arc. And it's a 5-point lead for O'Gorman. They were down 13-8 at the break. They've turned it around. Poirbert in the high post, spins, off balance, no. Higgins the rebound, but she's trapped underneath. There's a fight for the ball as players hitting the deck.
Yep, Stevens is doing a great job getting position on offensive rebounds.
Yeah, they have 6 offensive rebounds to just 1 for O'Gorman. Porter, the nice fake. No, it won't fall. Poirbert tracks it down, and she was tripped. Goes to the deck, lost the handle. Boy, more players hitting the deck. O'Gorman, fast break. No good by Terveen. Rebound, Higgins. Boy, it's getting physical, but the pass out of bounds by the Raiders, and they turn it over.
You know what? Both teams are just playing so hard, so aggressive.
Fresh shot clock. O'Gorman's going to launch a three. That's going to be off the mark, and the rebound to Poirbert. It's taken away from her and then thrown off of Poirbert. That was Terveen making a play for O'Gorman. And we got subs to the table for Stevens. A sub that's going to be Peterson in, Poirbert out. Thrown in to Ruby Moore. Terveen outside. Moore's jumper, good. Ruby Moore, her first point. She's just a freshman, and there's an errant pass stolen by Moore. Opportunity, shot, good. Ruby Moore, and Adam Dannenbring with 48 seconds left wants to call the 60-second timeout to settle his team down. As just like that, O'Gorman up 28-19. They've outscored the Raiders 20-6 in this quarter. As we get a look at the replay, there is Moore. Freshman says, hey, I'm open. Why not? After the steal. Just like that, the O'Gorman Lady Knights have turned this game around.
You know, Steve, you mentioned Molly leads O'Gorman in steals, career steals, but there are quite a few girls that have great steal numbers for them. Sydney Terveen averaging 2.1 a game. Julia Eggert averaging 2.2. And then both of the Moore girls averaging over a steal a game. So this goes to prove their aggressive, in-your-face defense.
And they turn those turnovers into points quite often. And that's what the good teams do. And that's why O'Gorman holds opponents to an average of 30 points per game. That is just unreal. And I remember, I think it was earlier this year, they held somebody to 13 points. or 16 points. That was Sioux Falls Jefferson. And they held Roosevelt to 16 points in the second and third games of the year. That's just in the day of the three-point shot and the shot clock, if you're holding teams to 20 points or under, and O'Gorman did that a couple of times this year with some other squads, that is five-star restaurant quality defense there by O'Gorman, as they are applying the double team here. Jones in trouble, throws it to the middle of the court, near steal. But the Raiders keep it. They need a bucket here, something to get a little momentum going into the halftime break.
Yeah, their offense, you know, was flowing really nicely out of the gate, and it seems to
Jones
hit a roadblock.
Yeah, Jones misses on the three, and the long rebound is out of bounds to the Lady Knights. 13 seconds left, shot clock is off. So now O'Gorman has a chance to maybe put an exclamation point to close out this period, which they've just dominated. Got to figure they're going to try to find Abdouche. She's not open, but here's Moore in the corner, short on the three. And that is how we will end the first half of basketball. What a quarter for O'Gorman. 20-6. That's how much they outscored the Raiders in that second quarter, and they have taken control as we've reached halftime of our first game of the day here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. We'll take a timeout, come back with more. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on SDPB3.
You live life on the move. While you determine what direction that may be, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with values. Go with friends. Go with support. Go with convenience.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Coverage of the South Dakota High School Activities Association event is made possible by a partnership between the SDHSAA and SDPB. Sponsors of SDPB's coverage include Dakota Bank, South Dakota Corn, and by Lloyd Companies, Bank West, South Dakota State University, the South Dakota Department of Education, and by your membership in the Friends of SDPB.
With the Bridgewater Emory Ethan Band playing in the background, I'm Steve Toom along with Tony Schmidt. Halftime of our first game of the day of the Girls Class AA Basketball Tournament here on SDPB3. And our score is Sioux Falls O'Gorman, 28. Rapid City Stevens, 19. And this is a tale of two quarters because the Raiders were up 13-8 at that first quarter break, but then it was all O'Gorman in that second period of play. Let's check out some of these first half highlights. And here you see O'Gorman with the ball as they go down to Okoye down low. Here's the drive, the shot, nice roll there for O'Gorman, but it was the Raiders with good shot selection. The three up and in by Finley Love. Scramble for the ball, a lot of players hitting the deck time and time again. There you see Talia Porter, one of their top scorers for the Raiders. She maneuvers inside, gets it. And here's Lucy Moore on the steal. Here's a nice bounce pass from Tervine to Eggert. Just great ball movement in the first quarter by the Raiders, not so much in the second quarter by the Raiders. And then some of the outside shots started falling in that second quarter for the Lady Knights, but it was their defense that really did the trick. As you take a look at the turnovers, O'Gorman had more turnovers in the first quarter, but look at there, 11-9. Most of those turnovers for the Raiders happening in quarter number two.
Yes, they just kind of got out of sorts a little bit. One of their main goals was taking care of the ball, and, you know, coach called a timeout to try to settle things down and remind them of their goals of taking care of the ball. But rebounding, again, a factor here in Stevens being in the game. So at the half, Rapid City Stevens leads in rebounding, 17 to O'Gorman's 13. And quite a few of those came on the offensive side of things, Steve, which is always helpful.
Yeah, for the Raiders, they have 17 rebounds. 9 of them are offensive rebounds. Eight of those are offensive rebounds. 3 offensive rebounds for O'Gorman in that first half. But the turnovers really piling up against the Raiders. That was one of the reasons they lost that matchup during the regular season back in early February. 47-35 was the final score in that game in favor of O'Gorman. And it seems like that script may be repeating. It wasn't that way at the end of the first quarter, but here at the halftime, you see O'Gorman with that defense turning up the pressure, forcing the turnovers, and turning those turnovers into points. 28-19, that's where we're at the break. We'll take a timeout. We'll come back. We'll have more here from the girls' AA basketball tournament here at Heritage Court at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls on SDPB3.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it, while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
At Bank West, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. Bank West.
We're all going somewhere, going higher, faster, farther, going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring, keep making memories, keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
Anthem Oats in Frederick is a proud community partner and supports high school activities in South Dakota. The Sumptions have been stewards of the soil since 1882. From the family farm right to your pantry. AnthemOats.com.
First Dakota is here for the shared community experiences, the competition, long-standing rivalries, the players and coaches, seeing friends again, and cheering on our favorite teams. It's what makes life great here, and First Dakota is here for it.
Don't forget to follow SDPB Sports on your mobile device all season long. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Be sure to also check out all our action and award photos by searching for SDPB on Flickr. Also, we want you to tell us where you're watching us from. You can also read some of our great stories online and watch some of our videos that features the teams, the players, and the coaches here in South Dakota. At SDPB Sports, hashtag SDHoops24, and wherever you're watching us from around the world on the internet, good afternoon, good morning, good evening. We don't know where you're at, but we're glad that you may be watching us. And we have heard from over the years from people around the world watching this, members of our military serving overseas. We thank you for your service. If you're watching us from an overseas base, welcome here. I hope we're giving you a good taste of home. And we've had foreign exchange students who have gone back home to their home countries who want to follow their friends competing at the state tournament. We've heard from them. We've heard about watch parties in Holland and Germany and France and Norway. So
Welcome, wherever you may be watching us from. I'm Steve Toom, along with Tony Schmidt. The teams are taking their shoot around. Okay, Tony, I'm going to put you in the coach's seat. First of all, for Stevens, what do you tell them coming out of the break here?
Well, they got to get back to how they were playing when they first came out. Taking care of the ball has to be a priority, and keep pushing on offense. Keep pushing the ball down the court and making O'Gorman react. I mean, when you let them sit up in that 2-3 defense, it's just going to be difficult. They're doing a good job. They're shutting Porter down, and she's a main part of their offense. I mean, at, 19, almost 20 points a game, they've limited her to 4 in the first half. So yeah. I think they, when they do have to set up a half-court offense, they need to work on getting the inside-out game going to try to open Porter up a little bit in the middle. Again, the outside shots. I think key points being, you know, take care of the ball and work on offense, work the inside out to try to get Porter some opportunities.
All right, so now what do you tell the players if you're coaching O'Gorman coming out of the break?
Keep doing what you were doing in the second quarter. They really turned it up. They just seemed a little bit out of sorts in the first quarter. It's not like them to have 9 turnovers in the first half of a basketball game. And I think, once they settled into things, they looked like O'Gorman's looked all year in the second quarter.
Yep, and that's why they've got this 28-19 edge as we are ready to begin the third quarter of play. They're going to be starting the B girls tournament shortly out in Rapid City. Give you an update from the A tournament there at halftime. That's being played up in Brookings. Sisseton leading Mount Vernon Plankington 31-26 there at the break there in Brookings. All the girls A, that's on SDPB2. Girls B is on SDPB1 television. As we get back to action here, third quarter underway. It'll be the Lady Knights starting the half with the basketball. Abdush gets the inbounds pass. See what the Raiders do different defensively here. Looks like they're opening up man-to-man. Now they're going to go to a double team. Oh, they nearly got a turnover there. That's Turvine. As somebody hit the deck. That was Finley Love, and we have a whistle along the baseline. Love, oh, looks like she got hit in the face. And we have a foul, and that's going to be on Peterson. That's her first. And Love is going to have to check out in favor of Mackenzie Schreiber.
Yeah,
looks like Love got hit in the nose. Boy, she went down and stayed down on the deck for a few moments. No whistle, and here's a drive by Moore. Block, foul. 2 free throws coming up.
Stevens doing a great job of putting man-to-man pressure on the Knights here.
Talia Porter just got called for her second foul. That sends Moore to the line. 3 points all at the free throw line today. And that one will fall. Ate a whole lot of iron. She is an 81% free throw shooter on the year. And you just watch her play and you just think this is a prototypical point guard the way she plays. I think she'll have great success at the next level.
Yes, the Moores have a great tradition of basketball. Of course, their dad, Keith Moore, was a outstanding player in the 80s, back in the 80s.
Yep, it wasn't that long ago.
at Northern State. And then, of course, her older sister, Izzy, is playing basketball at Augie.
And Augie's got a fantastic program. There's a drive and another foul on the Raiders on the move to the bucket by Turvine. Higgins, her first. 2 free throws coming up for Turvine, a 58% shooter at the foul line. That one will fall. Boy, some kind bounces here for O'Gorman. Early on in this third quarter at the free throw line, that one a little more traditional. 6 points for Sydney Turvine. She's a sophomore. Pressure by the Knights, looking for that double team. And here it comes. Jones manages to get her hands on the basketball.
32-19, O'Gorman fell behind early. They have been dominant since the beginning of the second quarter. Stevens looks a little out of sorts here against this zone. There's a three, it's on the way, in and out, and Okoye gets the rebound. Heartbreak there for the Raiders. They got a good look at the bucket. It was halfway down and popped out. More drives, no, tipped out of bounds to O'Gorman. Poor Bear checking into the game. Peterson checking out. She's limping a little bit as she heads. Her gait looks a little off as she heads to the sidelines. Hopefully she's okay. Hitching her step. As play resumes, Abdouche, a three. Yes, that was smooth.
You just can't lose her. She got caught behind the screen and...
Referee stopped play momentarily. I'm not what sure for. I was looking away. Not sure if somebody got a warning or something like that, but play will resume after the three. 35-19. This was 13-8 at the end of the first quarter in favor of the Raiders, but the Lady Knights have been dominant ever since. Jones. Can't find anything, gives way to Griswold. Now Porter spins, runs into Okoye, who blocked the shot, and Okoye just took it away. Porter's been held to just 4 points. She averages nearly 20. Nice give and go. Abdouche scores again. She's in double figures with 11. And O'Gorman has nearly doubled up the Raiders, and a foul at midcourt. And that's going to be, I believe, on Terveen. It is her first. Well, I don't know what Kent Colesrud said to him after the end of the first quarter, but I tell you what, I'd like to bottle that. Because his team has been playing outstanding basketball on both ends of the court since. Bounce pass tipped away, stolen. There's Abdouche getting her hands on the ball. Opportunity. Moore, yes, with the left hand.
Nice spacing coming in to the basket, and nice path by Moore on that one.
Turnovers into points. The calling card for O'Gorman. Porter runs into a player, throws it up and in. Talia Porter with six. She was just determined to get to the bucket. 39-21, O'Gorman, under 5 minutes to go. And the ball out of bounds. Timeout on the court. O'Gorman in charge here in quarter number three, back in 1 minute here on SDPB3.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour, you know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing, menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental. So they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal.
All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
Oh, my goodness.
Seriously. 39-21, O'Gorman leads Rapid City Stevens here. 4:49 left to go, third quarter, along with Tony Schmidt. I'm Steve Toon. Great to have you here on the first day of the girls AA basketball tournament. All 3 days we'll be here on SDPB3. Raiders get the ball after the break. They'll face some pressure. Jones lobs a pass ahead to Poor Bear, who's back in the game. There's a three on the way, short, no good by Griswold. Rebound Raiders, Poorbeard, no, off the window. Higgins is fouled underneath.
And it's those offensive rebounds paying off for Stevens.
Eggert with the foul, her first. Get a look at the replay there. Higgins has been working hard all game long. Higgins on the year, 60% at the free throw line. She has 7 points. That's her first point since the first quarter. Missed that one, tipped around. I think it's going to the Raiders, and it will.
So the Raiders shooting just 18% right now from the three-point line, and that was gonna, you know, that is a big factor. One, the coach mentioned, we've got to make our outside shots, where O'Gorman's sitting at 50% right now, Steve.
And the ball trickles out of bounds off Lady Knight. It'll stay with the Raiders. Yeah, shooting percentages, 27% for Stevens, 52% overall for the Lady Knights, as we've got a sub in. That is going to be Ruby Moore to replace number 31, Julia Eggert. So a little more speed in the lineup for the Lady Knights at 4:24 here in the third quarter. Porter determined to get to the bucket, can't score. Rebound, O'Gorman. It's Peyton Peterson with the ball.
Stevens sticking to that man-to-man defense, Steve.
A little misdirection, can't get free. Okoy puts it on the floor, shovels it up, and no good. Might have been partially blocked. Gorman back on defense. Here's Higgins, was open, couldn't fire the three. You mentioned it earlier, that defense for the Lady Knights, so fast. They have a lot of tall players that move quickly. Pass back to Higgins, short. Tipped out of bounds, that's gonna go to the Raiders. And Eggert back in, she'll give Okoy a break. Jones the trigger, Poorbear the quick shot, counted in the foul, just what the Raiders needed. Her first points. Lucy Moore just got her third foul. Tamaya Poorbear, 5'10 junior, averages 3.7 points, nearly 6 rebounds per game as Moore checks out of the O'Gorman lineup. 43% on the year from the free throw line. Scores. 3 points the old-fashioned way. Higgins out. Griswold out. Peterson back in for the Raiders. They'll bring Finley Love back in as well. Pile up in the corner. Who's it going to? The Raiders. Looks like they're going to get the ball. And they will. They're down by 14. But any sort of comeback for the Raiders has got to start with some turnovers, forcing them on defense and getting some points on the other end. Here's a three, it's too long, and the rebound pulled down by Turveen. Good look there by the Raiders, just couldn't cash in. But Stevens extending that defense. Eggert, the drive. Up and under, missed everything, but she catches the ball in the corner.
Got her own rebound.
And a timeout called by O'Gorman. Kent Colesrud saw something he didn't like, so he wants to settle things down here with his team, up by 14 points. Well, we got a moment here. I'd like to remind you that you can become a member of SDPB today. First Bank and Trust, with support from Van and Barb Fishbach, are inviting you to support high school sports on SDPB. Your new member donation will be automatically matched, doubling your gift. Take advantage of this match by donating today at sdpb.org. You can call 1-800-777-0789. And thank you to all of you who have supported SDPB over the years. All right, so what do you think Kent Colzer is telling his team in the timeout here?
I don't know what he saw there.
His team was a little bit out of control on that set. I mean, he's got the timeouts to spend. When you see something you don't like, it's like, hey, let's settle it down here. They've got 13 seconds on the shot clock to work with. Trevine will trigger at side court. Abdou scans the defense. High post, tipped away, foul. Poor Bear, that's gonna be her third. Fourth team foul. That's gonna get Higgins off the bench. Isabel Higgins checking in for the Raiders. That resets the shot clock with 2:57 left to go. Abdouche on the drive, the pull up, no good. And Higgins clears away the rebound, nearly tapped away from her. She'll give way to Jones. Porter with the ball. She's been relatively quiet today. And we're gonna have a foul, and that's gonna be on Eggert. That will be her second. Fourth team foul on O'Gorman. Raiders have only been to the free throw line just five times today. Jones fakes the three, looking for the shot, none there. Bounce pass, Higgins outside. Raiders moving the ball pretty well, just can't pull the trigger. Higgins blocked, foul. Eggert just got her third. She looks on in disbelief. Check out that last play. Yep, body contact. Higgins, one of two on the day, makes that to give her 8 points. McCoy, Lucy Moore in. Eggert, Peterson out. For the Lady Knights with 2:05 left to go. Higgins now with 9.
You know, she's done a great job.
Look out.
A great job in the paint for being 5'8 in there against the height that O'Gorman has with Okoye.
Porter just picked up her third personal foul as Abdouche went flying into the Stevens bench, trying to bring the ball up court. That's a big foul, fifth team foul. So it's the double bonus. Actually, both teams in the double bonus for the rest of the quarter. Abdouche now with 12. Jones out, Schreiber in for the Raiders. Abdouche on the year, 70% from the free throw line. Pressure is broken. Notice that a lot of the Stevens players were in the pink tennis shoes.
Yeah, the neons are back, Steve. Neons are back. You know, on offense, Stevens, I think O'Gorman must have had a talk about shutting down that first middle pass.
There's the layup put up and in by Ruby Moore as Okoye blocked the shot down on the other end. Here's a double team. And we're going to have, I think, a timeout called by the Raiders. as they are down by 16 here in the waning moments of quarter number three. While we got a moment here, I'd like to remind you that In Play with Craig Maddock features in-depth discussions about all things sports in South Dakota. Through these conversations, we learn about the players, the programs, and the legends who help shape the current sports landscape here in the Mount Rushmore State. You can find this podcast on Apple, Google, Spotify, and wherever you get your podcasts. Be sure to leave us a five-star review so that others are able to find it. In Play with Craig Maddock. Craig is out west covering Class B girls this weekend. And he does a great job with those In Play, those podcasts. They are fantastic. Craig, I've had the pleasure of calling games with him many times over the years, and he knows his sports history here in South Dakota. As we get back to action. Stevens, 25 on the shot clock to work with. Schreiber out on the perimeter, gives way to Peterson. Poor Bear with the drive, nice move. She's got five. Pressure broken by the Lady Knights. Under a minute to go. Oh, what a bounce pass, and Okoye, oh, missed it with the left hand, and Higgins with another rebound. That was a nice setup there by the Lady Knights.
See, they're cutting off that middle pass, that first pass. It was way more open in the first quarter, and they're just shutting that down.
There's a three that's up and in. Finley Love. And we will have a foul in the backcourt. And that's going to be on Love, and that's her third. So we see that last shot. She catches it, releases it quickly. Nothing but the bottom of the net. Two free throws coming up for Abdouche. So Love with three fouls, Poor Bear with three fouls, Porter with three fouls for the Raiders. That could spell trouble for them. As Griswold is in, Peterson out for the Raiders. Lucy Moore getting a break. Peyton Peterson, the senior, checking in to replace her for the Lady Knights. I remember a few years ago watching Amalia Abdouche play, I believe, as a freshman, and it was just going, wow, this young lady's going to be special. And boy, she has turned out to be a special player. Number two all-time scorer, number one in steals for the Lady Knights. And that's saying something considering all the players they've had wear the blue and white. And here's a steal by the Lady Knights. Outlet. Peterson shut off. Back to Tervine. Throws it outside. 8 seconds left. Oh, Okoye off her fingertips. It's going to go to the Raiders. Boy, Okoye was open in the paint, too. Porter's going to have to hurry. Oh, she's tripped up. And they're going to say no foul. And it's going to go to the Lady Knights. Coach Dannenbring off the bench, not happy about that. 3 seconds left. Abdouche is going to have to work in a hurry. She'll launch from half court. No. We're done with three. 45-32. Lady Knights on top. Back in 1 minute on SDPB 3.
It's time to focus on you. A healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small, just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business. Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
Well, Done with three quarters of basketball, 45-32, Lady Knights on top of the Raiders, along with Tony Schmidt, Steve Toom here. Tony, what are the stats telling you as you take a glance at them here at the end of quarter number three?
The stats are saying that Stevens is not shooting as well from the three-point line as they need to be a little more competitive in this game.
Overall, 47% from the floor for O'Gorman, 30% as a team for the Raiders. And O'Gorman is also 13 of 14 at the free throw line today, 5 of 7 for the Raiders. The three will fall for Porter. That one came almost out, but it fell. And a big bucket there for the Raiders.
They've flattened out the rebounding stats. The rebounding competition's about even right now.
Abdush misses, and Porter fighting for the rebound with a coy jump ball. Possession arrow, Lady Knights. Abdush with 15 points, leading the way for O'Gorman. 9 for Porter, top scorer for the Raiders. But Porter averages nearly 20. Raiders get the ball. Love near half court. He's looking at a double team, but gets it away to Porter. Oh my. Oh, oh.
We're letting him play out here, Steve.
Finley Love gets another three. She's got 9. Pass up ahead to Moore, who's back in the game. She sat a lot of that third quarter in foul trouble. Raider fans cheering D up, D up. They got a wide open shooter. Missing it was Turveen, and the Raiders get the rebound. Outlet, Love's got to chase it, saves it. Porter scores. 5-point advantage, O'Gorman, as the Raiders on a bit of a roll. Timeout, Kent Colesrud, he wants to talk it over. And the Raider fans making some noise here in the Pentagon.
Yeah, so Stevens pushing the ball up the court, not waiting for to set up half-court defense. They've been doing a great job of that. We saw it early on in the game.
There you see Finley Love, number 11. Firing that three-pointer as Porter was trying to clear out some space. Might have gotten away with an elbow there.
I noticed that too. They are letting them play a little bit today.
And that's typical at state tournament. I mean, I've seen it year after year, even going back, you know, to my high school days. You know, I was always thinking, you know, tournament basketball, it's going to be a little bit tougher, a little bit more physical. And they seem to let them play. And, you know, I kind of prefer that. Let the players play. You got to keep it within control.
Definitely.
Because I've seen it almost get out of control at times. But, you know, let them play. Let the players decide the game. Not have whistles decide the game. I've always had that philosophy. And yeah. I got to say, the referee's doing a good job. And let's congratulate our referees. It's a privilege and an honor for them to be selected to referee at a state tournament. And I think they've done a pretty good job today. And you know, like I said, there's been a couple of cases where they've let them play, but, you know, that's going to happen in the postseason.
It's certainly a tough job and an underappreciated job.
You bet. Here's Moore with the pull-up J, and she got it. Yep. And, of course, we need people out there. Hey, you can't have games without the officials. So if you're interested in being an official in any sport, contact the High School Activities Association. They'll get you set up. Always looking for those younger people to start.
Oh, wow.
Nice
oh, look.
Boy.
Nice look by Poor Bear, catching her open under the basket there.
And here's Moore on the run out, the scoop and the layup. She's got 11 now. Just to finish my thought, yeah, contact the High School Activities Association. They'll get you set up on a path to become an official. Again, can't play the games without the officials. There's a steal by the Lady Knights. That's Eggert, the stop. Oh, off the front of the rim, no good, but Abdush gets a rebound. And I think they're going to catch a foul on O'Gorman. Pushing. Abdush got her second foul on the push-off. 5:36 left. It was down to a 5-point lead. It's been extended back to 9 by O'Gorman. Big opportunity here for the Raiders. Dangerous pass. Player hit the deck. That's Finley Love again. Underneath the hoop in the hall.
And the crowd goes wild.
See who catches the foul there. As the bucket was scored by Terveen. Porter gets the foul. That's her 4th. That is huge as Finley Love has to check out. As she hit the deck again. Terveen at the line, 58% on the year. Misses it, tipped once, but into the hands of Higgins. Porter staying on the court with those 4 fouls. She has 11 points. 11-point lead, backdoor Higgins. Tipped away from her, saved by Porbear, back to Higgins. Put it up, missed it. Outlet, Lady Knights, bounce pass. Okoye had it, tipped away, it's loose. Who gets it? It's Abdouche. Pull up, Jay, no. Rebound, Terveen, or check that, Eggert, no. And Porbear comes away with it. Boy, they're letting him play. And finally, Jones will have it. Raiders cannot have many empty possessions from here on out. They have to be cashing in most every time down the floor. Porbear spins, lost the handle in midair. McCoy ended up with it.
I think she just expected a bump call there.
Yeah, but she just lost the handle. There was no reach in or anything as Abdouche drives, and we're going to have a foul away from or on the drive to the bucket. Timeout on the court, 4:14 left to go here in this 4th period of play, as that was Porbear picking up her 4th foul for the Raiders. We'll step aside for 1 minute here on SDPB3.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Left to go. Quarterfinal action here at the girls AA basketball tournament in Sioux Falls at the Pentagon. Along with Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toome. O'Gorman up by 11, 51-40. As we come out of the break, it'll be O'Gorman with the basketball. They'll throw it into Okoye outside to Moore. Fresh shot clock to work with. Both teams with 2 team fouls. Screen set by Okoye. She wants it. Abdouche the 3. No. And the rebound by Porter. Porter out there with 4 fouls. She's the top scorer on the regular season. And she has her shot blocked by Abdouche and a foul, and Porter might be gone. Oh, what a play by Abdouche. If that foul's on Porter, her afternoon is done. And it is. Wow, what a turn of events. As she finishes the day with 11 points, almost half of her average. And it's going to be Peterson in to replace her. So that mountain just got that much taller to climb for the Raiders. Down by 11, under 4 minutes to go, and their top scorer disqualified. Missing it was Eggert. And we're going to have a jump ball. And the possession arrow favors O'Gorman. Team fouls, three on Stevens, two on O'Gorman. Okoye was open, mishandled it, misses the shot, and Higgins yet another rebound. Higgins has been solid on the glass. That's her 11th rebound. To the corner. Peterson was open temporarily. Pourbaire trying to step through, has nothing. Here's a three on the way, short. Rebound tipped around and into the hands of Eggert, trying to get a jump ball. And now we will have a jump ball. Possession arrow, Raiders with 3:08 left. Into the corner, Love brings it outside. Pourbaire posting up, spins up and under. Yes, what a nifty move. She's got seven. Lead is nine. Raiders need some stops on defense. O'Gorman, let's see what they cook up here. And we're gonna have an offensive foul on Moore, and that's her fourth. Is that Higgins who held her ground?
Yes.
Boy, Higgins has just played stellar today for the Raiders.
She has had a great game. I mean, averaging this year just 6 points a game, five rebounds.
She has 9 points, 11 rebounds. Goes Isabel Higgins. She's one of the team captains for the Raiders. Love through traffic. Floats it up, off the window. The bank is open, Finley Love with 11.
That old school glass again.
I love it. Old school as the Raiders call a timeout. Finley Love, Coach Dannenbrink said about her, great defender, very quick and a streaky outside shooter. As for Higgins, she's the only senior on this Raider team. And she is going to Black Hills State, plans on majoring in business and participating in track and field. The lead seven, this one's not over yet, folks. O'Gorman on top. The Raiders' top scorer has fouled out. There's a lot of time left in this particular contest. Waiting in the wings, Sioux Falls, Jefferson, and Pierre. That'll be our second contest of the afternoon.
Nice crowd here today. You can tell we're on the eastern side of the state, can't you?
Well, you know, the weather's good today, the roads are good, and, you know, I was looking at the forecast, and normally for one of the basketball tournaments, it seems like one of the tournaments we're going to have bad weather. Well, the weather's good, and the weather, looking at the forecast for next week, supposed to be good, so, hey, travel restrictions or anything like that, no interstates closed because of blizzards, we love it. And so if you can get out to the games, whether it be in Brookings or Rapid City or here in Sioux Falls, by all means do so. If you can't make it, no problem. We got you covered. The best seat in the house on SDPB. Back to action. Lady Knights into the front court. Raiders looking for a turnover. Pass underneath. Okoye through her fingertips and out of bounds. That's the break the Raiders needed. Pressure by the Lady Knights. Jones bringing it up slowly. Now Peterson into the front court. Dangerous pass, but Pourbaire has it. Lobs it. Oh, dangerous pass, but somehow Higgins gets it. A three, short. Okoye clears it away. Outlet. Peterson with it for the Lady Knights. Boy, Higgins saved that play for the Raiders. They just couldn't cash in. Peterson being harassed by the Raider defense. Gets it outside to Moore. She'll settle it with 12 on the shot clock. Now Abdush will run the show. Oh, went between two players. Ruby Moore has it taken away by Jones. Raiders on the move. They can't afford to take too much time. They're down by seven. There's the shot from the corner. Go!
her first points of the afternoon. The lead is 4 for the Lady Knights. Moore's going to settle things down, and Kent Colesrew wants to talk it over. With 57 seconds left, team foul situation. Both teams one foul to give here with 57 seconds left.
Yeah, that's been an interesting change this year. You know, no more one-on-ones, no more taking the chance of let's get a foul and they might not score any. I mean, they get two shots, so.
Yep, and that is in boys and girls basketball, a rule change that I guess the rest of the high school associations across the country, they've been doing that for a few years now. South Dakota kind of falling in line in that regard. But, you know, you kind of miss the old one-and-one because that was the strategy for such a long time.
Yep, it's,
you know, 17 fouls, then 10 team fouls. That is no longer the situation. It's 5 fouls per quarter, and then it's the double bonus. Now, if we go into overtime, the fourth quarter foul situation goes forward. So if you're already in the double bonus, the fouls do not reset going into overtime. 4-point edge, 30 on the shot clock for the Lady Knights. And both teams one foul to give. And the Lady Knights will trigger it side court with Lucy Moore. When Jones was on the court, and Stevens had 6 players on the court, Jones will check in probably at the next whistle. And we have a whistle, and we're gonna have a foul, and that's gonna be on Peterson. So that was the foul to give for the Raiders. Now it's the double bonus. Moore looking for somebody and wants to call a timeout, and she will. For Stevens, they have 1 full timeout left. O'Gorman has 2 30-second timeouts left. Stats so far in this game, Stevens 35% from the floor, O'Gorman 43. From three-point land, 6 of 19 for the Raiders, 2 of 6 for O'Gorman. Turnovers even at 16 apiece. Rebounding, 30-28 advantage, Stevens. That's what we're at the moment. Okay, let's see what the Lady Knights have planned. Boy, Okoye's under the basket. And nobody's guarding her. Now Peterson's going to come over. Abdush gets the inbounds. Nearly thrown away. And there's the foul, and that's going to be on Love, and that is her 4th. That's one thing for the Lady Knights. They're a good free throw shooting team. As a team, 64%. More 81% on the season. But she misses the 1st of 2. Here comes Jones to replace Griswold in the Raider lineup. Missed them both. Rebound. Poor Bear has it. Lost it. Picked up by the Raiders.
Boy, that is super uncharacteristic of her.
Throws it to the outside. Here's a 3. Go! There's still a 4-second difference between shot clock and game clock. Abdush into the front court. Nearly stolen, but Love commits the foul, and she's just fouled out of the game. She'll end her afternoon with 11 points. Peterson open on the wing, knocks down the tray. And with 31.9 seconds left, both teams one timeout left. But O'Gorman has a foul to give. Griswold, the sophomore, checks in to replace Finley Love. 2 players have exited the game for fouls for the Raiders. But Abdush misses this. She's a 70% shooter. The door is open for the Raiders. Missed them both. Rebound. Higgins.
My goodness. Shot clock is off. There she is for three. And there's a foul on Jones. Two free throws coming up with 11 seconds left. My goodness gracious, what are we seeing here this afternoon? It looked like the Raiders were dead not that long ago. Now they're up by two. Free throw good. 16 for Abdouche. Timeout, Raiders.
Boy, this has just been a game of momentum. I mean, we saw the momentum one way in the first quarter. It went the opposite way in the second quarter. And right now, the momentum is certainly on the side of Stevens here in these final minutes.
Stevens has outscored O'Gorman 21-7 in this quarter. Unbelievable.
And it's come from the outside shooting, Steve. And that, again, Coach Dannenbring knew from the get-go that that was going to be a key factor in their success today.
Hallie Peterson averages 3.5 points a game. She has 9, all in this quarter, all on three-pointers. A 26% three-point shooter on the year. But the sophomore has stepped up in a clutch situation for the Raiders. For O'Gorman, they missed 4 free throws in a row from 2 of their best free throw shooters, Moore and Abdouche. Now Abdouche at the line. She has to make the second of 2. 11 seconds on the clock. Now here's the thing, O'Gorman's got a foul to give, so they can take a chance defensively no matter what happens here.
Yep, this rebound, if the rebound was ever important.
I think commits the foul.
There goes their one to give.
Yep, no free throws coming. And so Coach Dannenbring's yelling out instructions. They've got to play it in. That was the fourth team foul. Jones gets it in, but it's stolen. And a foul on the Lady Knights, or on the Raiders rather, as they make a critical error on the inbounds play. That was a foul on Griswold. My goodness. 8.8 seconds left, and O'Gorman's getting 2 free throws.
Freshman, first state tournament.
Yep, it's Ruby Moore at the line. An 80% free throw shooter on the year. Her team down by 1. But she misses it. 1 of 7 are the Lady Knights in the fourth quarter at the free throw line. Got it. We're tied. No timeouts for the Raiders. Here comes the pressure. They'll throw it in. Can't afford to take much time. Jones working into the front court. She'll launch it from half court. No, we're going to OT. Took too much time getting up the court.
Yep, that full court pressure.
And so, 4 quarters, not enough to decide this one. We're going to overtime. The 8 seed and the 1 seed. What a fourth quarter comeback by the Raiders. They outscored the Lady Knights 21-8. And O'Gorman, remember at one point they were 13 of 14 at the free throw line. They're now 15 of 23. And by my count, 2 of 8 in that fourth quarter of play at the free throw line for O'Gorman. Wow, for a team that shoots 64% as a team. Well, what a start we have to this AA tournament. As we go into overtime here, okay, what's the strategy, Tony? What do you tell, first of all, for the Raiders? What's their strategy got to be?
Well, they have two key players sitting on the bench right now. But taking care of the ball has got to be, if O'Gorman's smart, they are going to pressure them and try to force turnovers into this overtime.
On the court, Peterson and Higgins, their top scorers with 9, 7 for Corbear. Porter and Love both have fouled out. They scored 11. 16 for Abdouche, top scorer, 11 for Moore for the Lady Knights. So here we go again. It'll be Higgins and Eggert in the center circle. 4 minutes on the clock. Both teams get a timeout, so that means the Raiders have 1, the Lady Knights 2. And Abdouche controls the tip. Possession arrow favors the Raiders. Abdouche with the drive. Eggert tapped away. Ooh, diving for it and a timeout call. Ooh, a diving for it and hitting her knee hard was Terveen, and she gingerly gets up. A quick 30-second timeout saves possession for O'Gorman. So with not even 20 seconds into the overtime period, and O'Gorman's got to spend one of their timeouts.
Fouls continue to be a factor. O'Gorman has one foul left to give, right, Steve?
No. They have 14 fouls, so it's the double bonus. Okay. Hey, want to tell you, coming up next weekend will be live coverage of the boys' basketball championships. We'll start 1 week from today. Class B, that'll be on SDPB 1. Class A on SDPB 2. Class AA will be right here on SDPB 3. You can watch all the action online at sdpb.org/basketball. So it's free throws for both teams from here on out. 18 on the shot clock. Abdouche wheels around the right side, gets to the rim. No. Terveen fighting for it, off her fingertips, out of bounds to the Raiders. Raiders were down big going into the fourth quarter, but they made a big comeback. Corbear has it, lost it, got it back. Peterson is open in the corner. They'll lob it to Corbear. She's bottled up. Griswold passes it. Higgins missed it. Fighting for the rebound. Jump ball possession, Raiders.
Isabel Higgins stepping up in the paint again.
12 rebounds.
Yeah.
And she's made a lot of plays that hasn't shown up in the playbook. Abdouche tips it out of bounds. It'll stay with Stevens. O'Gorman unbeaten on the year. They beat the Raiders by 12 during the regular season in early February. Here it has been a different story. Bounce pass kicked. It'll stay with Stevens. And Griswold will handle it. Knight staying in that 2-3 zone. Bounce pass, tapped away, but Jones got it back. 10 on the shot clock. Corbear maneuvers, spins, counted out of foul! Oh my! Oh, they called offensive foul, or they called travel. No basket.
That's a controversial move, too, Steve.
Mm-hmm. Jones collects her second personal foul.
We can hear the people behind us arguing if that's a travel or not.
Yep. Moore at the line, missed her last two. She made that one. Give her 12 on the afternoon. Got them both. Give her 13. The lead is 2. Jones staring over that trap. Here it comes. Dangerous pass, and it's taken away by Moore. What a play by Moore.
You could see she had her eye on that one, too. She was getting that steal. She watched it come across, and anytime you're passing across the court like that, you're asking for trouble.
Griswold tried to prevent the layup, but Moore was able to muscle it up towards the rim and completes the old-fashioned three-point play. She has all 5 points for O'Gorman in the OT. 2:20 and counting, O'Gorman by five. Jones across the timeline. There's Higgins, she's open but quickly covered. Three on the way, that's short. Rebound, Griswold on the weak side. Abdouche got near steal, out of bounds. It's going to the Lady Knights. That was a smart play by Turveen. Threw it off of a Stevens player. Minute 56 left.
Steve, how big is it that Stevens' two leading scorers, top two scorers, are sitting on the bench watching right now?
It's got to be killing them. Considering their teammates made a miraculous comeback, that three misses, and there's Higgins, yet another rebound. Still a two-possession game. Don't need the three if you're the Raiders right now. Higgins is open, but misses everything. The rebound on the weak side to Eggert. Oh, Morrow didn't see that coming there. Caught her by surprise. Minute 15 left. McCoy underneath. Foul on the Raiders. Two free throws coming up. Pat Peterson the foul, her third for the Raiders. McCoy at the line, 58%. It's just 4 points, make it five now. Now the Lady Knights finding their rhythm from the free throw line, and a timeout, the last one called by the Raiders. They're down by six. This next free throw is key with a minute and 11 seconds left.
I suppose Dannenbring is writing up a three-point play here.
I think he's thinking, you know, we're going to have to set up some sort of three-point play. There's just not enough time left. Even if the free throw is missed, it's still a six-point deficit.
Two possessions,
but they got to be threes. Peterson has hit three, but the problem is their top two other three-point shooters are on the bench, Love and Porter. They're the only other players that have hit three-pointers today. Save that, it was Schreiber. Schreiber hit a three-pointer early on. That was in the second quarter. That's her only bucket. We'll see if she steps out onto the court. It will be Porbear, Jones, Griswold, Peterson, Higgins on the floor for the Raiders. Abdouche, Turveen, McCoy, Moore, Eggert on the floor for the Lady Knights. Big free throw here, could turn it into a three possession game. In and out, and Turveen, oh, chased it down, but it's off of Porbear, out of bounds, and a costly mistake there by the Raiders. They couldn't secure the rebound. O'Gorman, they can just run some time. The clock is the enemy for the Raiders. They're down by six.
And this is where that one-on-one rule change, Steve, really impacts the strategy here.
Oh, a near turnover. And it's going to be a jump ball, I think. And the possession arrow, unfortunately for the Raiders, it favors O'Gorman. So a good defensive play there. But the O'Gorman Lady Knights get the ball on the alternating possession. And that was a mistake there made by O'Gorman, because they threw that ball, nearly threw that ball away. They get a break on the alternating possession. Abduce to trigger. She'll have Griswold right in front of her. No timeouts left for the Raiders. One left for O'Gorman. Oh, nearly thrown away. Jones fighting for it, and she gets called for the foul. That's her third. Boy, O'Gorman, they've had a couple dangerous passes here in the last few seconds. More two free throws. That makes it a three possession game.
She must have just been trying to make the game interesting earlier. She's just draining her free throws now.
Yeah, missed two in the fourth quarter. Very uncharacteristic of her, and that one is in. And the lead is now eight. Boy, and players still hitting the deck as Trevine went down. Poirbrer bringing it up, launches it towards the corner, and Higgins, she'll drive, swatted by Akoi, foul. For Akoi, believe it or not, that's her first foul. She played very physical today. That was her first foul. Comes in overtime with 42 seconds left. Higgins. Gets that one to fall.
What a game for her.
Yep, she's in double figures now. She's got a double-double, 10 points, 14 rebounds. Got them both. Now here comes Shriver into the game to replace Higgins. A little speed out there, try to force a turnover. Full court pressure for the Raiders. See if they commit a foul in the backcourt, trying to force a turnover. They get it to Abduce in the middle of the court, and she's just going to race around. And there's the foul, and that'll be on Griswold, and that'll be her fourth. Higgins will come in. Check that. That's the fifth on Griswold.
Three starters now on the bench for Stevens.
Actually, Griswold's a bench player. Three players overall, but Griswold's one of their top reserves. Abduche at the line. 16 points. Make it 17. Foreman been much better at the free throw line in overtime as they were in quarter number four. And as soon as I say that, I jinx him. That ball will go to the Lady Knights. Up by seven with 31 seconds left. Shot clock is off. Akoi wide open, missed it. Rebound to Jones. Shriver open, wants to settle for the three. No, had a clean look. The long rebound chased into the corner. Higgins gets it again. Jones a three, and that's good. No timeouts left for the Raiders. They got to play defense. Moore to the middle of the court. Now they get Molly Abduche. And here's a foul out on the perimeter with 6 seconds left. And that'll be on Higgins. Only her second. So 6 seconds left. O'Gorman's going to survive a first round scare. Got them both. She has 19. Jones looking up court. Will launch it. No. And the game will end with a final score of 64-58 in overtime. It's O'Gorman prevailing. The number one seed survives barely here in round one of the girls AA basketball tournament on SDPB3. O'Gorman outscores them 11-5 in the overtime frame. And they did it at the free throw line. Moore going 5 of 5, 3 of 4 for Abduche, 1 of 2 for Akoi. That was the difference in overtime for the O'Gorman Lady Knights. A three-pointer by Jones, a couple of free throws by Higgins. Those were the only points for the Raiders in overtime, as this one had momentum swings throughout the particular contest. And the Raiders looked like they were not going to make a comeback at all, but instead, they made a comeback with Porter and Love on the bench in foul trouble. And what an effort by the Raiders. They did not give up, and they managed to get this game into overtime. But some free throws by the Lady Knights in overtime get away with Sioux Falls O'Gorman. Tell you what, why don't we take a break? We'll come back. We'll have more. The postgame show here, O'Gorman and Stevens. O'Gorman prevails in overtime here on SDPB3.
We hope you're a fan of stories about heroes, because we'd like you to meet a few of ours. These folks keep our communities moving forward. They're dedicated to being here for you, navigating change, keeping you secure, and offering a helping hand to those who need it. Heroes come from many walks. Ours are here to walk with you. Go with trust. Go with people. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
I was looking for something that was gonna be close to home.
Southeast Tech has definitely helped me. I'm actually doing something that I enjoy.
This is the right place to be.
Get your degree, get to work at Southeast Tech.
Beginning April 6th, watch SDPB Saturday evenings for a new lineup of shows. Start the night laughing with Keeping Up Appearances at 5, 4 Mountain. Then, the drama unfolds with back-to-back episodes of Midsummer Murders. Tag along with private investigator Alexa Cross in My Life is Murder at 7, 6 Mountain. Followed by the fan favorites Doc Martin and Father Brown. Plus, Sister Boniface joins us on Sunday evenings at 6, 5 Mountain.
Well, it took overtime, but eventually the number one seed keeps their undefeated season alive. O'Gorman over the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens. Tony, let's take a look at these second half highlights here. And just when O'Gorman thought they had this one put away in the third quarter, the Raiders came back. But great play underneath by Higgins kept this team alive. See the block, but the foul called. Lucy Moore on the run. Nice finish there by O'Gorman. They dominated that third quarter, but boy, what a comeback by the Raiders. Finley Love hitting that three-pointer there. Outlet, Lucy Moore on the drive. The up and under move there. Poor Bear, the nice spin move. Look at that finish. And then there was Hallie Peterson with the three-pointer, three of them, but what an overtime by Lucy Moore, scoring 7 points in overtime to help lead the way for O'Gorman. For Stevens, they had three players with 11 points. Talia Porter, Finley Love, they both fouled out. Isabel Higgins, 11 points, 14 rebounds, 9 points for Peterson, all on three-pointers, seven off the bench for Poor Bear. For O'Gorman, 19 for Molly Abdouche, 18 for Lucy Moore. I mentioned seven of those in overtime. Five assists for Abdouche. And she also had five steals as well. She fills up that stat line. 8 points for Sydney Tervine, 7 off the bench for Ruby Moore. From the floor, O'Gorman, 42% overall, 36% for the Raiders. Rebounding, plus 6 for the Raiders. They pulled down 14 offensive rebounds compared to just 8 offensive rebounds for O'Gorman. Turnovers, 20 for the Raiders, 16 for O'Gorman. From the free throw line, 7 of 9 for Stevens, 24 of 34 for O'Gorman. So they got to the free throw line much more often in this particular contest than did the Rapid City Stevens Raiders. So it's O'Gorman moving on. Raiders will move into consolation play tomorrow afternoon. Let's step aside for a moment. We'll come back. We'll get you set up for our next matchup. It's Pierre taking on Sioux Falls Jefferson, back in a couple of minutes right here on SDPB3.
Our teams are committed to improving quality of life in our communities. Whether we're planning construction concepts, building a new downtown development, bringing new businesses to our communities, or maintaining your apartment home, we believe everyone deserves a well-built and well-managed place to live and work. This is Lloyd.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Oh my goodness.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
And welcome back to round one of the girls AA basketball tournament here on SDPB3, along with Tony Schmidt. I'm Steve Toom. Our first contest went overtime. O'Gorman prevails over Rapid City Stevens, 64-58, in case you're just joining us. Now we move on to game number two of the day, the 4-5 seed matchup. 4 seed is Sioux Falls Jefferson, the 5 seed, the Lady Govs of Pierre T.F. Riggs High School. Let's meet the Lady Govs. They come in at 15-6 on the year. They lost, or they actually beat Jefferson late in the year, 51-47. That was the second to last game of the regular season for the Lady Govs. And they have a trio of standout players in Lennox Dupree, Ryan Berry, and Reese Terwilliger. That's the big trio. Terwilliger at 15.5 points, Dupree at 15, Berry at nearly 12 points per contest. And some of these players getting looks, actually some have signed at college, some others are getting looks, but this is a team that really, Tony, I think those three players, they all got to be in double figures today for Pierre to prevail.
Oh, for sure. Yep, they looking down the stat sheet, Steve, they are leading in all of it. Points, rebounds, assists, steals. Definitely the core of the Pierre team.
Take a look, Kirk Bebout, the head coach there for Pierre Lady Govs. They go to the bench. It'll be Brianna Sargent, Lavin Price, and Grace Richter, along with Addison Soma. There you see some of their wins during the regular season. They beat Huron handily in the Sodak 16, 63-36 to get here to the state tournament. They are 15-6. Here's their lineup with Ryan Berry, a senior, Lennox Dupree, a 5'6 junior, Graceland Taylor, a 5'5 junior, starts along with Elise Christofferson and Reese Twilliger. And if that name, Lennox Dupree, she is the granddaughter of Terry Dupree, legendary basketball player who was actually drafted by the Detroit Pistons back in the day. We're going to take a timeout, and we will come back, and we will meet the other team, the Cavaliers of Sioux Falls, Jefferson. More from the Pentagon in a couple of minutes right here on SDPB3.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do. And that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Established in 1986, the Great Plains Tribal Leaders Health Board represents 18 tribal communities located in South Dakota, North Dakota, Nebraska, and Iowa. Our vision is that all tribal nations, communities, and citizens achieve optimal wellness through the embrace of traditional cultural values and innovative and holistic healing practices, strengthened by tribal sovereignty. For more information on our grant programs, health services, and career opportunities, visit our website at greatplainstribalhealth.org.
SDPB brings you the South Dakota Boys State Basketball Tournament. You can catch all the action Thursday, March 14th through Saturday, March 16th. For more information, including multiple ways to watch the games live, go to sdpb.org/basketball. Complete coverage of the South Dakota Boys State Basketball Tournament is brought to you by Dakota Bank and SD Corn.
We are back at Heritage Court inside the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls. Day one of the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on SDPB3. Along with Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toome. Our second matchup of the day features Sioux Falls Jefferson taking on Pierre T.F. Riggs. The 4-5 matchup. Let's meet the Cavaliers of Sioux Falls Jefferson, the new high school in Sioux Falls. Only been around a couple of years, but they've made a splash at the state tournament with head coach Sean Tiva Pruitt, who used to play at Roosevelt, had a stellar career there. Take a look at their games during the regular season, where they ended 15-5. Then they beat Watertown 52-41 in the Sodak 16 to put them at 16-5. Brindley Altenberg, Abby Horner, Aaliyah McGovern-Harrington, Jaden Dunn, and Ashlyn Johnson, their starting lineup. We have three seniors, a freshman and a sophomore. And let's talk about that freshman. Brindley Altenberg averages 17 points, 3 rebounds a game. And Tony, I think she's made a splash here in South Dakota high school basketball.
Yep, just really this year showing up. She has already several college offers out there. Creighton, SDSU, and USD, and she'll be playing ball this summer for the Elite Youth Basketball League, so the EYBL, out of Iowa. So yeah, she's been in the game several years, but really breakout this season.
Jaden Dunn averages 12 points per game, one of the other top scorers, along with Aaliyah McGovern at nearly 8 points per contest for the Cavaliers.
Yep, and her, of course, signed at SDSU to play there next year. She's a force in the paint. One of the best post players in the state, Steve.
Yep, Jaden Dunn at 6'1" and a senior. And Dunn has 71 blocks on the season coming into tournament play. That is an amazing number for the Cavaliers. You take a look at the brackets. O'Gorman has already punched their ticket to the semifinals. They'll meet either Sioux Falls, Jefferson, or Pierre. And then tonight, we'll start at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time with Mitchell and Harrisburg. And then it's East meets West, Brandon Valley and Spearfish. It's about as far apart as you can get for schools, right there along I-90 there. 3-seed Brandon Valley, the 6-seed in Spearfish. The Cavaliers average 53 points per game. They give up 39 on defense. Meanwhile, Pierre, they're averaging 51 points per game. The Lady Govs shoot 45% from the floor, 58% from the free throw line, 27% from beyond the arc. And for the Cavaliers, they are a 37% team from the floor, 65% at the free throw line, 31% from beyond the arc. And while we got a moment here, I want to send a special shout out to Brian Oakland, who is broadcasting the games day for DRG Media Group. And Brian has helped us out with volleyball in the past, and he's seated to our right here. Brian really bailed us out during volleyball because I got sick and I couldn't go out and cover volleyball on television for SDPB. And Brian was able to step in and do a fantastic job. And I was talking with him today. Turned out he had just cleared COVID one day before I gave him the call. It says, Brian, can you help us out? And he did. So thank you to Brian Oakland. As we get ready for the introduction of the starting lineups, let's turn it over to our public address announcer.
Good afternoon. The South Dakota High School Activities Association welcome you to this opening session of the State Girls High School Basketball Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activities Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you enjoy the games and support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. Our second game features the Governors of Pierre Riggs and the Cavaliers of Jefferson. And now let's meet the cheer teams. First for the Governors, Gracelyn Bowman, Ella Dowling, Alyssa Howard, Riley Nelson, Taylor Newell, Mindy Riggle, and Kaylee Tostenson. Cheer supervisors, Courtney Paulson and Amanda Stoser. Now let's meet the cheer team for the Cavaliers. Macy Adams, Vivian Arango, Bailey Bovey, Jessa Dykstra, Amy Guzman, Samantha Coster, Olivia Lacroix, and Lydia Reyes. Cheer supervisors, Mackenzie Jensen, Laura Weiss, and Katie Kruger.
Time. It represents the past, the present, and the future, all at the same time. When you hear that it's state tournament time, what do you think about? Do you think about moments in the past? Maybe you think about one of the previous state championship teams. Or maybe it was the time your team came up just short and you can't shake it from your memory. When you hear it's state tournament time, do you think about the present? Do you think about the peer governors? Or do you think about the Sioux Falls Jefferson Cavaliers? Or maybe when you hear it's state tournament time, your mind goes to the future. And time will tell who is left standing and celebrating with this trophy and leaving with these nets. Time can represent many things, but this moment right here, this is your time.
And now let's meet the starting lineups in alternating fashion. For the Governors, at guard, a 5'8" senior, number 3, Elise Christofferson. For the Cavaliers, at guard, a 5'6" senior, number 1, Aaliyah McGovern. For the Governors, at guard, a 5'6" junior, number 10, Lennox Dupree. For the Cavaliers, at forward, a 5'9" sophomore, number 13, Abby Horner. For the Governors, at guard, a 5'8" senior, number 13, Ryan Berry. For the Cavaliers, at forward, a 6'1" senior, number 21, Jaden Dunn. For the Governors, at forward, a 5'11" senior, number 15, Reese Terwilliger. For the Cavaliers, at guard, a 5'7" senior, number 23, Ashlyn Johnson. For the Governors, at guard, a 5'6" junior, number 20, Gracelyn Taylor. And for the Cavaliers, at guard, a 5'10" freshman, number 24, Brindley Altenberg. The Governors are led by Kirk Bebout, assistant coaches Terry Becker, Cherish Blanchette, and Jeff Shackleway. Leading the Cavaliers, Shantiva Pruitt, assistant coaches Derek Dunn, Sarah Zerfel, Mark Eisenbry, Ethan Fries, and Paige Beck. Your officials for this game, Scott Whitlock, Bo Garcia, and Eric Grokot.
We're ready for game number 2 of the afternoon. Jefferson in the home whites, Pierre the road blacks, and it's going to be Jefferson controlling it with Altenberg. Averages 17 points a game. Left-handed pass goes to Dunn. The drive, the layup scored by Johnson, who averages 4.5 points per game. And just like that, Jefferson on top. Matchup of the only two schools in the big school ranks that have green in their color scheme. Left-handed shot, no good by Terwilliger. Rebound to Dunn. Yeah, for a long time at a tournament, if you saw green, it meant Pierre. So anymore with Jefferson in the mix, and the layup, no good by Dupree. Pierre gathers the rebound. They'll set it up top with Christofferson. Terwilliger works against Dunn, gets loose, and that one will fall. Terwilliger with the left-handed finish. Pierre going man-to-man right away. Oh, dangerous pass tipped around. Who gets it? Jefferson. Pass tipped, and Dupree has it. Gives way to Berry, gets it back, fires the shot, and it's good, it's a 2. Four, two, Pierre on top. Altenberg had it partially blocked. Ends up in the hands of Taylor. Terwilliger had an open lane, and she's going to draw a foul and 2 free throws coming up.
She was open for a while at the elbow there. I think there was some confusion on the part of the Cavalier defense.
But Johnson will pick up the foul, first of the game. Free throw good by Twilliger, 54% on the year. That one no good. And the stick back by Pierre, no good. And finally Dunn clears it away. 5-2, Pierre, here's a drive, shut off. Open shooter, good on the three, it's Johnson. She has all 5 points for the Cavaliers. Corner, Dupree had it momentarily. Christofferson spins it around to the opposite corner. Nothing there for Taylor. Taylor, long pass, nearly overthrown. Dupree with the drive into Terwilliger, through traffic, no. Tip back to Terwilliger, outside. Pierre will reset, they get the fresh shot clock coming up on the 5 minute mark. We're in quarter number one. Oop, that went through the hands of Barry, but she got it back. Nice fake, open, Taylor missed it. Rebound, Jefferson. Court quickly as Horner. Dunn on the perimeter. There's Johnson again. Check that, Horner with the ball. Too high off the window, but Dunn cleans it up. No, gets it back. Gets the bucket. Jaden Dunn, 6'1". You can't coach height.
Yeah, she is just so long in there and can pull rebounds down.
Dupree in the corner, can't fire the three. Looking to drive, throws it outside. Barry has it, stops. Coming up on the 4 minute mark. 10 on the shot clock. Christofferson, Taylor open, three, in and out. Rebound Altenburg, the freshman on the move. Gives way to Johnson, skips it over. Here's a drive, pass thrown away, ends up in the hands of Pierre as McGovern lost it there. Christofferson will reset. Terwilliger puts it on the floor, back outside to Barry. Terwilliger, free throw line jumper, no, the rebound to McGovern.
That's the second time she's had a wide open look at the free throw line.
And we'll have a holding foul, and it will be on Pierre. And that will be on Terwilliger. Timeout on the court, 7-5, Jefferson on top, back in a minute, right here on SDPB3.
Dreamer, doer, difference maker. These are just a few things we look for when growing our team at Dakota Bank. Those with empathy and a commitment to doing what's right build their careers with us. If you're about relationships and helping others, Dakota Bank is calling. Will you answer? Go with integrity. Go with teamwork. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Seven-five early on here in favor of Jefferson over Pierre here at the girls AA basketball tournament, SDPB3, along with Tony Schmidt. I'm Steve Toom. Pierre ended the season at the number 4 team in the final poll. Jefferson, number 5 in the final poll, but
because of the PowerPoint rankings, those teams flip spots. So it's Jefferson, the higher seed here at the state tournament. What have you seen early on, Tony, from the way these teams have played?
Well, Pierre is matching up man-to-man. It has been. It seems to be working for them, and it looks like Jefferson is in the zone in either a 1-3-1 or a 3-2 zone that's, I think, trying to control the outside shot there.
Pierre brings the ball down the court after the Jefferson miss. Here's a three. It's no good, and there's Christofferson fighting for the rebound. It skips out of bounds. It'll stay with Pierre. Christofferson has that big brace on her left knee.
These teams match up very well. I mean, Jaden Dunn in the center just being a force, and of course Terwilliger is a powerful force in the paint for Pierre. Just a really good athlete.
And that shot will not fall. Terwilliger tried to tip it to herself, and Dunn clears it away. And up court, Johnson gives away to McGovern. Back to Altenberg. She'll run the show. She does not play like a freshman.
No, she does not. And she is just so long for a guard. I mean, point guard handling the ball like that.
At 5'10", and that shot hit the top of the backboard. That's out of bounds on the putback attempt.
At 5'10", exactly. Like
the last player I saw that that reminds me of her size, the way she plays, was Maya Selk.
Yep.
And she ended up with a pretty good career. But when I see her play, I see, you know, shades of Maya Selk. I remember calling her at state tournament when she was a freshman, calling action here on SDPB. And we have a foul in the paint, and that's going to be on Jefferson. I think that was on Horn. Yep, Abby Horner, that's her first, team second. Fresh shot clock for Pierce. They'll trigger it in. Barry looking, gets it in to Christofferson. Christofferson, a standout volleyball player. Terwilliger throws it outside. Drive, shut down. Terwilliger, an open jumper. Yes. She has five. Pressure now by Pierre, but it'll melt away. Altenberg brings it up. Altenberg with that left-handed dribble. Into the game is Taylor Silvernail, number three, handled it momentarily. Dunn with the rebound. McGovern got it. That's a three. It's 27% from beyond the arc. Averages nearly 8 points, three rebounds a game. The senior. Yeah, Harrington, and there's a shot up, no good by Pierre, but Terwilliger gets the rebound on the miss by Grace Richter, number 23, who's into the game.
Yeah, so if Pierre can spot those opposite side blocks are open on Jefferson's defense here, and it looks like they're trying to get it in there.
That was Richter who slipped. And the traveling call gives the ball to Jefferson. They'll face the pressure. Altenberg gets it, and there, that pressure just backs away. Willer picked up by Christofferson. The jump step, no. Somebody hit the deck hard. That was Barry, and out of bounds. And oh, Barry is slow to get up. That is not a good sign. Ryan Barry, the 5'8" senior. She's going to stay in the game.
Steve, did you know that she is a kicker? She was a kicker for the state championship football team at Pierre this year.
Was that Barry?
Yes.
Ah, that's right.
She's a really good soccer player. And I think she's signed somewhere to play soccer.
We'll check our notes here in a little bit. She's actually going to play, Ryan Barry's going to play basketball
at
Chadron State.
Okay,
3-year starter, and was a kicker indeed. Standout soccer player. And the coach's notes was that there were a bunch of colleges looking at her to go to soccer at the next level. As there's a turnover, as McGovern ends up with the ball. Pass ahead, but it's behind That's Taylor Silvernail, the 5'9 freshman who just checked in not that long ago. Opportunity goes by the wayside for the Cavaliers. At half court, just shy of the mark. We're done with one period of basketball. Low scoring affair here. 10-7 in favor of Jefferson. Back in a minute right here on SDPB 3.
You've worked hard to build your business, your reputation, your success. Your financial partner should be committed to digging in to drive your vision forward. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there. We'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other. Lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Michael Jackson playing over the PA here as fans get a chance to dance and stretch here during the break. 10-7. Jefferson on top of Pierre after one quarter of play. Both teams not shooting well from the floor. 4 of 12 for Jefferson, 3 of 12 for Pierre. Jefferson's knocked down a couple of three-pointers. And they have a free throw to their credit. Or check that Pierre has a free throw to their credit. Bounce pass into the paint, nearly lost. Williger was bottled up, and here's a shot from the outside, no good by Berry, and the rebound comes down to Johnson, or check that to Horner. Altenberg looking for the three.
Got it. Left her open for a second, and she got it off and good.
Quick release.
Doesn't
need much of a window. No wonder, and we're gonna have a travel call on to Williger. That's why you've got colleges already scouting her out as a freshman. And big time colleges too. Altenberg bringing it up, chased by Christofferson. Good matchup there. McGovern can't fire the three. And I don't know how much you think, Tony, being a left-hander has an advantage at the point guard spot. I think you get an edge.
I do, too. I mean, you're just kind of trained to push people left.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know what the percentage breakdown is. It'd be interesting to know. But, yeah, left-handed point guards are hard to come by, and I think people are just used to pushing people left.
McGovern to the line, foul on Taylor, her first for Pierre. McGovern at the line, 75% on the year. Up and in. I'm trying to think of left-handed point guards from like the NBA, but my memory's coming up a little faulty at the moment. I'm sure something will hit me about 3 o'clock this morning. As Dunn gets the rebound, counted on the foul on the putback. Jaden Dunn. Sensational.
And that's where her length just shines through. Just so smooth, up and over, and up and in.
Free throw on the way is good. She's also a 68% free throw shooter on the season. When you have a post player that's that skilled and can hit better than 2 out of 3 free throws, that is money in the bank. Into the paint to Williger. Throws it to the outside. Berry's open a three. In and out. Halfway down the pier gets the rebound. Berry will reset. To Williger. Open. And she traveled.
I think she's maybe just so surprised. She's so open in the middle of the paint, Steve. It looks like they're sitting in a 1-2-2, and they're leaving the middle open. And I think there was pure shock on her face the first two times. And yeah, they're leaving that open and then collapsing and trying to keep the outsides covered, I think.
Yeah, and sometimes you get too wide open and you just kind of panic. It's like you're expecting that contact. Well, we've got a moment here. I'd like to remind you about Tales from the Hardwood. You know, high school basketball is a huge part of what represents our communities and towns across South Dakota. Now, on Saturday, March 9th, join us as we take you on a journey into some of these stories about the players and the teams that surround the basketball courts here in the Mount Rushmore State. From honoring a longtime coach to a student manager whose skills extend to a much different kind of court, we'll also meet a player turned coach, see how one student athlete has dealt with a unique disability. All this and more on this year's edition of Tales from the Hardwood. That'll air after the championship game on Saturday, March 9th. That'll be on SDPB 1 television. Fantastic job by our crew to put that program together. So many interesting stories across the state every year. And we are very, very honored to tell you about these great players, coaches, and individuals across the state. 17-7, Jefferson opening up the lead to double digits, and they've got the ball coming out of the timeout by Pierre. Nearly lost, but Jefferson retains. Jefferson, was it a couple of years ago, knocked off Washington when they were an 8 seed and Washington was the 1 seed.
Yeah, I think this is Jefferson's third year, and they've been a force.
In and
year.
Out, yeah. That's where Shantiva Pruitt has done a fine job building this program from scratch. Oop, near travel again there. Here's a drive by Dupree, throws it outside. Good ball movement by Pierre as Berry gets it to Williger, open from the free throw line, but misses it. Had a good look, and Horner clears the rebound. Pierre just seems a little out of sorts.
Yeah, Terwilliger seems a little out of sorts in the paint.
Gustafsson guarding Altenberg. Here's the pass to Dunn, but she lost it off her fingertips. Terwilliger was there for the steal. Berry pushes it ahead. Taylor, jumper, no. Terwilliger up high for the rebound. Berry, the open jumper, no. Boy, they're getting good looks, our the Pierre Governors, but
yeah,
just
falling
not
for them.
Falling.
Yeah, they're 0 for 5 right now from the three-point line. Shooting 18% from the field at total.
Almost an acrobatic shot there by Altenberg. We got a timeout on the court before these free throws are coming up. It's 17-7. Jefferson on top. Back in a moment right here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
.444 left to go until halftime. Jefferson up 17-7, despite the fact they haven't scored in the last 2 minutes and 12 seconds. But Pierre, they've only been shooting 18% from the floor here in the first half. Along with Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toom. Great to have you here. That last foul was on Terwilliger, her second for Pierre. And that sends Altenberg to the line on the year, 71%. Freshman. And the free throw's good.
You know, I got to catch up with Coach Bebout yesterday during practices, just talking about how they came off, you know, runner-up for state double A's last year and what kind of transitions their team has had to make to get back to the state tournament this year. But three starters back from last year, but playing a lot of different roles, doing more, just changing things up to still be competitive here at the state tournament again.
Dupree misses the shot, but Christofferson tracks down the rebound, and she was fouled and pushed by McGovern, and that is her first. Team's third. Check that, team's second. Here to play it in from the baseline, taking their time. Ooh, dangerous, but Dupree got it. She has yet to score. Oh, and there's a turnover as Dunn ends up with it. I think she carried the ball. Double dribble. Either way, it goes back to Pierre. Christofferson has to adjust her hair there momentarily. And she'll kick it into Barry, and here we go. Here, really struggling, only 7 points, 17% from the floor. Dupree traveled, took a little stutter step when she got the ball, another turnover for Pierre.
Just some unforced turnovers today.
Richter in, Taylor out for Pierre. Altenberg with the left-handed dribble. Christofferson fights through a screen, but Altenberg gets loose. Oh, just a little too strong. Twilliger with the rebound. Foul, Jefferson. That'll be on Jaden Dunn. That's her first.
So Bryn really taking advantage of their, you know, she had a couple open three looks early on, but they're adjusting to the pick, getting through the pick. And she took advantage and took it right to the hoop that time.
Twilliger open in the paint. The ball movement by Pierre. Dupree thought about it. Throws it outside. The open shooter is Christofferson. In and out. Another heartbreak miss there for Pierre. Down low, turnaround, no good. Missed there by Cameron Whiting. Just checked in. Whiting, a senior at 5'8". There's an open shooter, missed by Dupree. The rebound to Horner.
Good ball movement by Pierre on the offensive end here.
Pass tipped, but into the hands of Horner. Bounce pass. And a timeout, I think, has been called by Jefferson. Yeah, they want to call the timeout here as they were a little out of sorts, and Shantiva Pruitt wanted to get things under control here with her team up by 12.
Pierre has great ball movement on offense, and their shots just aren't falling here yet.
Yeah, Pierre has yet to score in this period. They're 3 of 20 from the floor, 15%. And they're 0 of 7 from beyond the arc. That is stunning for a team that's pretty good shooting, 45% overall. Turnovers relatively even, 7 for Jefferson, 6 for the Governors. Rebounding, even up, plus 1, Cavaliers. So triggering it in will be Johnson. Altenberg at the head of the lane.
Ooh, that was a good idea. Pierre just got around too quick.
Yep, Pierre has a lot of speed on this team. Pass underneath, and we're going to have a jump ball. Yes, we will. McGovern forces that as she and Richter were battling for it. Possession arrow, Cavaliers. 2:34 left. Pierre yet to score in the second period. They're on a long scoring drought. Thing is, Jefferson, they've haven't scored a lot in this period either. 9 points. But they haven't made a field goal in nearly 5 minutes. And Altenburg lands awkwardly. Two free throws coming up as she was fouled as she shot the ball. Terwilliger just got her third foul. That's huge. Altenburg's free throw is good. Williger is going to have to check out. So Pierre's going to go with a little smaller lineup with their center on the sidelines. 7 points for Altenburg, and it's 21-7. Pierre needs to crank up that offense here. They can't afford to fall much farther behind.
And they can't afford to have one of their best post presences sitting on the bench either.
That one, Dunn's on the other side. Pass ahead, corner on the drive. Oh, she double dribbled. A break there for Pierre as the Cavaliers turn it over. 2 minutes and 2 seconds left to go here in the first half. Pierre needs to find some offense. They're shooting 15% from the floor. The corner, Barry launches a three. No, they're getting good looks. They're just not falling. Here comes Jefferson the other way. Altenburg a three. Oh, it was online, but just a bit short. Christofferson cleared the rebound. Dupree yet to score in this game. Ball's loose, but it's picked up by Pierre. And we're gonna have a kick ball on Jefferson.
I think her foot just actually got in the way there.
Yeah, yeah.
On the bounce.
Taylor Silvernail in, she'll replace Altenburg, give her a break. And that's actually a big plus here for Harrisburg. They can pull Altenburg, give her extra rest going into halftime with their team up by 14 as Dupree finally breaks a long scoring drought. First points of the second half or second quarter for Pierre. Now they'll apply the pressure. Dunn will bring it up. Corner with the ball, under a minute to go. There's Johnson, a three, yes. Ashlyn Johnson, her second tray of the game. 24-9. Dupree is tripped. And that will be a foul on, I believe, Abby Horner. Yes, it is. Second on Horner, team's third. On the baseline, Barry has it looking. Outside, there's Richter with the drive. Barry, the open shot. No, had a good look. Rebound to Horner. Shot clock is off. McGovern looks back, sees that shot clock is off, and now walks it into the front court. See if they'll play for the final shot. Johnson thought about the three. Under 10. The drive, no, but Dunn is there. Puts it up, no. Rebound, fought for, look out. Christofferson and Dunn there. Possession arrow Pierre on the jump ball. With 1.1 second left.
You know, any post player that has been in the game a while knows the less you dribble in the paint, the better off you are. And if you notice, Jane there didn't drop it. She turned, pivoted, right back up with it.
The shot from half court is no good. And Jefferson with a big advantage here at halftime, 24-9. They have the lead over the Pierre Governors. Back in a couple of minutes right here on SDPB3.
As much as you have accomplished, there are times you'd rather not go it alone. While you determine what direction you go, We're here to help along the way. So go. Go with community. Go with neighbors. Go with understanding. Go with support.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Anthem Oats in Frederick is a proud community partner and supports high school activities in South Dakota. The Sumptions have been stewards of the soil since 1882. From the family farm right to your pantry. AnthemOats.com.
Beginning April 6th, watch SDPB Saturday evenings for a new lineup of shows. Start the night laughing with Keeping Up Appearances at 5, 4 Mountain. Then, the drama unfolds with back-to-back episodes of Midsummer Murders. Tag along with private investigator Alexa Cross in My Life is Murder at 7, 6 Mountain. Followed by the fan favorites Doc Martin and Father Brown. Plus, Sister Boniface joins us on Sunday evenings at 6, 5 Mountain.
...24-7, Jefferson leads Pierre here at halftime. Game number two of the day here from the girls' AA basketball tournament at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Along with Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toome, and the first half highlights, well, it's going to be a lot of Jefferson and missed shots by Pierre. That time Barry got that opening jumper. That was her only bucket of the first half. Jaden Dunn dominating down low.
Yes, she has just been a force down there, and with her length and her just smooth post moves, she's tough to guard.
It's Altenberg digging it in, throwing it in there, but there was Terwilliger who got a steal, but Terwilliger got into foul trouble. She was on the bench with three fouls, and there's Ashlyn Johnson knocking down one of her two trays in the first half of play. Let's check out some of these team stats. Look at that. 4 of 23 from the field for Pierre. That's 17.4%. Meanwhile, Jefferson at an even 33% at 7 and 21. But that second line, yep, that's the telltale stat there, three-point shooting.
Yep, it is. Pierre has just not been able to connect from out there. They're getting some open shots. Jefferson sitting back in that zone, kind of letting them get it into the middle, letting them kick it out, and they're just not falling from the outside for Pierre.
Yep, rebounding relatively even, turnovers relatively even, but Pierre only scored 2 points in that second quarter, and that was by Lennox Dupree, and that is just stunning. A team that scores 51 points per game in the Pierre Governors, they only have 9 here at the break. That is just stunning. Let's take a timeout. We'll come back with more here from the girls' AA basketball tournament here on SDPB3.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do. And that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Oh my goodness.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour, you know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing, menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal. All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
We're all going somewhere. Going higher, faster, farther. Going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring, keep making memories, keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
And welcome back to Heritage Court inside the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, the site for the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament for 2024. Along with Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toombe. Great to have you along for the ride this afternoon. And don't forget, you can follow SDPB Sports on your mobile device all season long. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Also be sure to check out all of our action and award photos by searching for SDPB on Flickr. You can tell us where you're watching us from, read some of our great stories, and watch some of our videos that features the teams, the players, and the coaches here in South Dakota. At SDPB Sports, the hashtag is SDHoops24. There's action happening all over the state today. And don't forget, next week, we'll have more basketball action from Aberdeen and Rapid City and Sioux Falls. It's the Boys Basketball Championships. Live coverage begins a week from today, culminating with the championships on Saturday, March 16th. If you want to watch Class B, go to SDPB 1 next week. Class A, that's on SDPB 2, and Class AA will be right here on SDPB 3. Don't forget, you can watch all the action online, sdpb.org/basketball. Tony, okay, you're in the Pierre locker room. What do you tell your team coming out?
Well, I am going to tell them to keep working. They've got to get some second shots, especially when their first ones aren't falling. But keep taking care of the ball. I would put on some more full court pressure, Steve. You know, they start, they are in man-to-man. They put one person up there, but I think anything to help them get some transition offense going, because their half-court offense is struggling right now.
All right, and on the other side of the ledger, if you're in the Cavalier locker room, what do you tell your team at the break?
Clearly they are doing what they need to do to cause some uncomfortableness on the offense. Keep that up and keep using their size as their weapon, because right now, especially with
Terwilliger,
yes, that on the bench, they're significantly have an advantage in the paint.
Get a look at some of the action there from the first half, as you see Dunn with that big rebound and put back on the missed free throw. Three-pointer from the outside there. That was McGovern with the shot. Dupree, that was her only bucket of the first half. She averages 15 a game. She was not getting a whole lot of looks. As you see Ashley Johnson knocking down the three-pointer there for the Cavaliers. And it was just a really good defensive effort by Jefferson. Again, Pierre had good looks at the basket. Shots just not falling for him here. They need to find a way to turn this around and get back into this contest. Now, earlier today, we saw the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens. They were down by a bunch, managed to come back, force overtime against O'Gorman. Let's see if we have a repeat of that here, and if it's Pierre that can mount the comeback and get back in this one. They're down by 15 here as we're getting ready to start the third quarter of play. Don't forget, two games coming up tonight. We'll start at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time. Harrisburg taking on Mitchell. Then it's Spearfish against Brandon Valley.
Yeah, so our first game was really a game of streaks back and forth. And, you know, if this one is, it's certainly Jefferson's advantage right now.
And if you're Jefferson, I think you just want to let's keep the pedal to the metal.
Exactly. You know,
keep your foot on the gas and don't let them back in, because another thing in these three-day tournaments, and I'll be thinking a little bit ahead here, you're Jefferson. If you can build a big lead, you can maybe start pulling some of those starters in the fourth quarter. But you got to play solid basketball to get to that point.
Right. Rest on the first day is gonna help day two and three.
And we've seen that with teams mounting furious comebacks as McGovern fires the three but misses from the corner. The long rebound pulled down by Horner, and she had it taken away by Taylor. And I've seen that happen at state tournaments where a team makes a great comeback, they win, and, or, you know, on both sides of the ledger, they make a comeback and then they got nothing for the next day because, you know, their gas tank hit empty. That one is no good. Another miss by Pierre, and the rebound to Jefferson.
Well, they're continuing to try to play that inside out game. But the thing is, when you have four on the perimeter, Steve, your rebounders are limited, obviously.
Dunn advances to the bucket and scores, and Terwilliger had to be careful out there with those three fouls. And that could present huge opportunities for Jaden Dunn here in the second half. Terwilliger's out there starting that third quarter. She gets the ball and misses the shot, and she's fighting for a rebound and a jump ball. And that's another thing you have to be careful out there. If you're in foul trouble fighting to try to get a jump ball, there's a very good chance you may get tagged for a foul.
Exactly, absolutely. Playing in foul trouble is, you have to be careful.
And you have to be smart. Gotta pick your opportunities carefully. Well, there's a drive and a shot, no good by Barry. Rebound to Williger, misses the stick back, and Dunn is there to clear it. Up ahead, tapped out of bounds, and that was Taylor who tapped it out of bounds, intended for Johnson. It'll stay with the Cavaliers.
Yeah, and to stay on that point of playing in foul trouble, it takes a level of aggressiveness away from you. So
it was tipped into the backcourt. Altenburg retrieves it, gives way to Johnson. Backdoor McGovern. Got position. No. Rebound Barry. Long pass ahead. Dupree. Wife gets her way through traffic. Shot was short. But it's scooped away by Taylor and outside to Terwilliger. Dupree will reset. Can't get the shot. Terwilliger. Nothing there. Dupree launches a three. That one's good. And finally, a shot falls from Pierre. That's their first three of the game.
One for 10.
And Dupree has to stop an entire shoe here. She has some colorful sneakers.
Not as much neon on the court as last game, is there?
No.
You're trying some a little bit more pressure full court here.
Dupree read that one and gets the steal. Chased by Altenburg. No, but a foul. And Altenburg will pick up her first. Dupree, we've got a lefty versus lefty here on the fast break. Don't see that too often. Lennox Dupree on the year 69% at the free throw line. Makes the first of two. Now Pierre's got to find somebody, get some points on the board.
Yeah, that's the thing with them. You know, they're three core scorers. If they're not scoring, they have a couple, but no more in double digits.
Timeout called by the Cavaliers. So they want to talk things over here. Up 26-14 here with 5:36 left to go here in period number three. You know, basketball isn't the only thing going on, neither is wrestling. Also, gymnastics happened back in February, and we recorded the state high school gymnastics competition, and we got highlights for you coming up from the top individual performances from each apparatus. We present that on Sunday, March 17th, 1 Central, noon Mountain Time, SDPB highlights from the state gymnastics competition. That was on the same weekend we had the team dual championship. So hats off to our production and engineering crew as they were all over the state that weekend. And we managed to get the action covered from the two wrestling sites and from gymnastics as well. And after the timeout, Jefferson plays it in. To the high post and done. McGovern goes to the outside, and we're going to have an offensive foul on Liam McGovern. Setting the illegal screen. That's her second foul.
It looked like she was just moving on the screen. Mm-hmm.
Berry with the ball on the right wing. Skip pass to Taylor. Nothing there for her. Now she'll fire, and she'll hit it. Defense backed away from her. Gracelyn Taylor averages 4 points a game. The 5'5 junior. Here down by 10. We found a little offense here in the last few minutes. And the ball out of bounds. Timeout on the court. 4:53 left, third quarter. Jefferson up by 10. This is Class AA Girls Basketball on SDPB3.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
And we're back inside the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls. It's Pierre against Sioux Falls Jefferson. I'm Steve Toombs. She's Tony Schmidt. Great to have you here with us today. Earlier today, it took overtime, but O'Gorman beat Rapid City Stevens 64-58. This game number two of the afternoon. Pierre has been shooting cold. 20% from the floor, 6 of 30, 8 of 24 for Jefferson for 33%. And we're going to have a foul out on the perimeter with Christofferson picking up her first.
You know, Jefferson, Altenberg does a great job coming off those screens. So many times players don't use the screens as much as they could, coming directly off the side, so it helps, and you can pick up the pick and roll, but Altenberg, again, right there.
She has 9 points. Top scorer for Jefferson. As Dupree lost the handle, opportunity for Jefferson. Altenberg layup, got it. Just like that, we're back up by 14. Pierre won the regular season matchup by 4. That pass tipped away, but Dupree has it.
Long arms guarding the point.
Down low to Williger. She is hooked up, block and foul. Two free throws coming up. That will be on Dunn, her second. Check it out again, is a little out of control, but there was a bump. Twilliger has been in foul trouble a good chunk of the game, but she makes that free throw. Give her 6 points. Richter in, Taylor out for Pierre. She has 7 points on the afternoon. Lead is a dozen for Jefferson. Good ball movement by Jefferson to break the press. A little bit of an errant pass. Dangerous pass there. Johnson somehow collects it. Corner outside, Altenberg. Open jumper, no. And the weak side rebound to Barry, and she's fouled in the backcourt. Corner just got her third foul. She has to check out in favor of Taylor Silvernail, the 5'9 freshman who averages 4 points, 1.5 rebounds per game. Player for the Cavaliers in foul troubles. Terwilliger with the left hand scores. She's got 9. The lead is 10. There's that pressure you were talking about, but Cavaliers break it. Silvernail in the corner, up top, wide open. Altenberg releases short on the three. Terwilliger outlet blocked, but it's returned to Pierre. Barry with the ball, skip pass over Dupree, a three, no, a little too strong, but Terwilliger gives it back to Dupree, a little give and go, and a foul on Jefferson. Johnson pointing on me. Ashlyn Johnson, her second. I'm gonna say it wasn't the act of shooting. So that's going to send Terwilliger, a 54% free throw shooter on the season, for 2 opportunities. She's now got 10 points. Nope, on the second. But a big accomplishment for Pierre. They've cut that deficit to single digits. Pass tipped and out of bounds. Good defense by Pierre. Altenberg with the inbounds. Pass tipped. Dupree has it. Pull up Jay, short. McGovern gets the rebound. Johnson ahead of everybody. Blocking foul.
That one could have gone either way, Steve. She looked like she had position.
Let's check it out on the replay. Johnson's moving in.
Can't get them all.
Inbounds goes to Jefferson. McGovern, oh, she just lost the handle. I think she was going to make a pass. Well, call it for traveling. So it's a turnover either way.
Pierre wasn't out of this. I mean, there's 9 points here, and they've had a few, they've seen a few fall, which is always nice with confidence. And
yeah, by no means is this game over, especially when you've got a player like Lennox Dupree in the lineup who can score a lot in a hurry. This player can score as well. Terwilliger, here's a shot from the corner. No. Rebound Johnson. Again, Pierre had a good look at the bucket. Here's a three by Silvernail. No. Rebound fought for, out of bounds to Jefferson with a minute 26 left. Richter out, Taylor in for Pierre. We got Horner in and Johnson out for the Cavaliers. Done with the inbounds. Travel, turnover.
It's a little stutter.
Opportunity for Pierre. Down by nine. They've played much better here in this third quarter. Dupree. To Williger, an open jumper. Yes. She's playing with much more confidence. The lead is seven.
We've seen some hit the bottom of the net, and that always helps.
Tapped out of bounds into the Cavalier bench. It'll stay with Jefferson. Run way outside. It's like Pierce switched up to his zone. McGovern for three. That's good. She has seven on the afternoon. The lead back to 10. Shot clock off. To Williger at the high post.
She is wide open if she turns and pops that free throw.
See if Pierre wants to play for the last opportunity. Berry a jumper. No. Rebound Horner. She will not get a shot off, and we're done with the third period of play. 33-23. Jefferson on top of Pierre. Back in 1 minute on SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great. Like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Ten-point lead for the Cavaliers as we enter the final stanza of regulation play here at the girls' AA basketball tournament. Along with Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toome. Jefferson by 10. Pierre shooting a bit better. Their shooting stats better. They're up to 22% now. Jefferson at 37%. But Pierre, 1 of 12 from beyond the arc. At least they hit a three-pointer in that third quarter. Jefferson 5 of 11 from three-point land. Turnover 16 for the Cavaliers, 9 for Pierre. Rebounding plus 3 Cavaliers. Pierre going man-to-man.
Yep.
Looking for a little pick and roll there. Dunn finishes. She's got 9. What a player she is. Oldenburg leading the way with 11 for Jefferson. Williger top scorer. Here's Berry, a 3. No, off the mark. Rebound fought for. Saved by Christofferson. And Williger will get some free throws coming up. That might be a foul on Dunn. If so, that is her third. Check it out on the replay. It is her third. To Williger, 12 points. Makes the free throw there. Only four players have scored for Pierre. Dupree, Berry, to Williger, and Taylor. Four players have scored for Jefferson. McGovern, Dunn, Johnson, Altenberg. Oh, do we have a lane violation? We do, and that's going to give another opportunity for Terwilliger. break for Pierre. But they missed the free throw. Lead 11 for Jefferson. She's looking for the screen. And another moving screen, an offensive foul. And that is on Horner, and that's her fourth personal. She'll have to check out in favor of Ashlyn Johnson.
On that screen, she gave a little bit too much space, and she tried to creep over and get her girl to have an effective screen, and it just didn't, she got caught.
Dupree open a three, too strong. Rebound, Silvernail. McGovern throws it outside. Johnson open a three, no. Rebound, Silvernail. New shot clock for the Cavaliers. Dunn, oh, did it go off her fingertips? No, it missed everybody. Out of bounds to the Governors.
Jefferson had such wide open spaces on that offensive run there, giving Jaden the entire paint to work with. It was just too good to be true, Steve.
Sometimes you can be too wide open. Bounce pass to Williger. She's gonna get more free throws. And that's done. That's her fourth foul. So credit to Williger. She has played really good basketball and not picked up that fourth foul. And she's forced Dunn into four fouls, but the free throw's no good. Cameron Whiting into the game, the 5'8 senior, averages 2 points, 1.7 rebounds per game. She'll spell Dunn. Missed another free throw. Four in a row missed by Terwilliger. Opportunities going by the wayside for Pierre.
Yeah, this 11-point difference is shooting. I mean, obviously, but the percentages on free throws, the percentages from the field, they're just not going down for Pierre.
Johnson misses everything. Barry ahead, Christofferson, bounce pass. It's taken away by Silvernail. Up ahead, Altenberg all alone. That's the finish. And a quick timeout called by Jefferson. As they get the run out, and Shantiva Pruitt wants to talk it over. Let's check out that last play. Altenberg. Easy.
With the right hand.
With the right hand. Or as Yogi Berra used to say, she's amphibious.
Yeah.
In this case, she can shoot with both hands instead of hit from both sides of the plate. 5:31 left to go in this game. The winner gets O'Gorman in the first semifinal game tomorrow night here at the Class AA basketball tournament. Great that you could join us here on SDPB 3 and around the world at sdpb.org. Pierre, after the timeout, see what Coach Pruitt has cooked up. Maybe a little wrinkle defensively. Terwilliger open, scores. Gives her 15 on the afternoon. Pressure broken. Here comes the double team. Johnson in trouble, but she's fouled. Oh, and she got hit by the side of the face. Maybe in the nose. And that's going to be Christofferson. That's her third. First team foul on Pierre. Altenberg has it stolen away by Dupree. The run out and the bucket. Dupree with nine. The lead is nine. Silvernail gets it back to McGovern. Ooh, near steal. Did get the steal. Christofferson. And she
took it right away from her.
Taken away. No foul. It's out of bounds to Pierre. Timeout on the court. 4:35 left. Jefferson up 37-28. Back in a minute on SDPB 3.
You're committed to building relationships, to exceeding expectations, to serving your community. Your financial partner should share your vision and your values. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Welcome back to Sioux Falls and the Pentagon Heritage Court here, the site for the 2024 Girls AA Basketball Tournament. I'm Tony Schmidt, I'm Steve Toome. 4:35 left to go in regulation. Jefferson up by nine. Pierre with the ball from the baseline. Oh, well, Dupree almost had it taken away, but a quick timeout called by Pierre to save the possession. Tony, what have you seen here so far in this fourth quarter of play for both squads?
Well, Pierre has improved their offense this quarter. Still even matchups. We have Dunn's been out for a couple minutes, so they must be giving her a break. She has four fouls, so saving her in case they need her at the end of the game. But yeah, Pierre just needs to keep executing, trying to get open shots and make shots.
I wonder if they go inside to Terwilliger with Dunn on the bench, because Terwilliger has played a sensational game with 15 points, but here comes Dunn. She's back on the court with the four fouls for Jefferson. Let's see if Pierre will attack. Here's Terwilliger, gives it up right away. They're trying to set her up, but instead of three, will be fired and missed. But Dupree, the rebound. Steps back, gets a three. Good!
She knew where she was, and she wanted that three-pointer instead of a two-pointer.
The lead's down to six. Dunn in the middle of the court. Find a guard in Johnson. Well, McGovern has to do a little tightrope walk there, but keeps possession. Bad pass, stolen away. Christofferson, she'll let the traffic pass her by. Dupree thought about it. Barry's gonna reset. Don't need to be in a hurry if you're Pierre, but you gotta find that opportunity. Dupree,
yep.
Terwilliger, bounce pass. Dupree has to go to the outside. Terwilliger, open jumper, short, rebound. McGovern, outlet, Altenberg. No, rebound, Silvernail makes another big play. McGovern for three, no. Rebound, Silvernail. Boy, she is fighting in there hard. And the jump ball and get possession to Pierre. That's the freshman out there, Taylor Silvernail. She's made some key plays at times in this game. She'll check out and get some warm congratulations from a friend. You love to see the hustle out there from that bench player if you're a Cavalier fan. And there's a steal by McGovern. Nice head fake. Oh, what a play. She's nice. Got nine.
Yes, nice steal and then nice pump fake to get that defender to fly by.
Barry misses it. Altenburg with the rebound. Momentum on the side of the Cavaliers. Pass, McGovern. See if she'll slow it down. She'll throw it to the outside. McGovern's gonna fire a three. Bingo!
Great ball movement by Jefferson. From the transition to the half-court offense.
That could have been a backbreaker in favor of Jefferson. Oh, McGovern almost got another steal to Williger. And, oh, she's gonna be fouled, and I think Dunn just fouled out. See that three. As that shot was put up by McGovern, and Jaden Dunn has indeed fouled out. Ends the afternoon with 9 points. And also with 8 rebounds. To Williger at the line. Makes that free throw. Second one in the air, no. Rebound, Johnson. See if the Cavaliers maybe take a little air out of the basketball. 2 minutes to go, up by 10. Altenburg picks up her dribble. 12 on the shot clock. Corner in there with 4 fouls. Taken away by Dupree on the run out. Oh, and she was fouled by McGovern, and that will be her third personal foul.
You know, it's a smart play. She's trying to take the ball away before she shoots, but so many times it's in the action. So it's
yep.
In the action of shooting, it's going to be a shooting foul.
10-point lead with a minute 42 left. 5 team fouls on Jefferson, just 1 on Pierre. So Pierre will get some free throw opportunities here down the stretch, but they've got a big hole to climb out of. South Dakota Public Broadcasting's coverage of high school sports and activities is made possible through the generous support of viewers like you. A contribution today helps us support the broadcast of events such as the State Basketball Championship, which you're watching right now. Make a donation to the Friends of SDPB by visiting sdpb.org. You can sdpb.org/donate. Want to make sure I get that right. Or you can scan the QR code that's on your screen right now. Make the support to the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, SDPB. We always appreciate your support. South Dakota has been one of those states when we compare to other states across the country. One of the top states per capita as far as their support for public broadcasting, and we do appreciate it. Dupree at the line. 2 of 2 on the day, 69% on the year. Big free throw made there. It's still a 3-possession game. Well, right now it is a 3-possession game. Got them both. Pierre needs to force some turnovers. They have fouls to give, so they can take some chances. Altenburg. Facing a double team, throws it ahead to Horner, and they just get it across the timeline. Now let's see if they'll play keep away. Altenburg will put up a shot, it might have been blocked, and Dupree ends up with the loose ball. Pierre can't afford to take too much time.
No, and a three is crucial here.
And they'll get some free throws as it was Christofferson trying to sneak in through the back door. Whiting gets the foul. That's only her first. Christofferson at the line, yet to score today. 40% on the year in the free throw line. That's a big one there. Got them both. Her first 2 points of the afternoon. Lead is eight. Here comes the double team. And a quick timeout called by Jefferson. They want to talk it over here against this full court pressure with the lead at 6 points. Two possession game. Definitely not over. You saw that earlier today when it looked like Stevens was out of it. They came storming back in the fourth quarter. Tied up O'Gorman, sent it to overtime. Eventually, the Lady Knights won 64-58.
Yeah, so Jefferson probably trying to make a plan for adjusting to this full court pressure. I mean, they need to get turnovers to get it back into the game here with just a minute remaining. And full court pressure is going to help them do that.
Jaden Dunn is on the bench in foul trouble. And you like a player like that. If you have a tall player, you can at least get the inbounds pass to her. And she's a very good passer. If you got a player that's like 2-3 inches taller than everybody else, that's the person you want to see to inbound and then outlet to a guard. But Dunn's on the bench. She's fouled out. So somebody else is going to have to step up. And movement's the key. If you're the offensive team, you want to be moving. You can't stand still and let that double team happen. You have to be moving to get open for that player to find you and get into space.
Right. So Jefferson, I'm sure, is making a plan for that.
Minute 9 left. Altenburg gets it. Pressure backs away. Christofferson's been chasing her all day. Ooh, McGovern almost lost it. And it's loose, and Dupree has it. Drive, scoop layup is good. It's a 4-point game. McGovern, bounce pass. Altenburg, here comes the double team. Altenburg gets it back. And there's going to be a foul. Now Pierre, they've got to commit some fouls. Because that's only their second team foul.
Boy, we couldn't ask for two better games this afternoon, could we, Steve?
Well, Pierre seemed out of it for a long time, but they've managed to close the deficit to four. They need to get a turnover. Shot clock is off, and Dupree's going to have to commit another foul. So that's the thing. They're going to have to just commit the foul. But then, with the new rule, Jefferson will get two free throws if they get to the free throw line. Got to have a designated foul person in this particular case. And Twilliger's not the person.
It can't be her.
Yeah. And that's the person you probably want in Richter, because that's only her first personal, but some precious time ticked off the clock there. And now a timeout has been called. Timeout called by Pierre. I think they want to get the designated foul person coordinated.
Yeah, they need it. He needs a game plan here. We have two possessions. They need two possessions to even tie this.
Yep. So here's the thing, is you take a look at the stats here as we're at this moment in the ball game with 26.5 seconds left. Two of 16 on 3-point shots for Pierre. 6 of 15 for Jefferson.
Yeah, 12.5% versus 40%.
Turnovers, 22 for Jefferson, 11 for Pierre. So Jefferson, by not taking care of the basketball the way they should, they've opened the door for Pierre. Johnson the trigger. Near steals, McGovern gets it. Pass tipped, and there's the foul, and that's going to be on Christofferson. That's her fourth, and that will be the 15th foul. And about 4 seconds ticked off the clock there. Horner at the line, yet to score today. 5'9 sophomore, 52% on the season. Missed it. Richter out, Taylor in for Pierre. Shot clock will be off. Got that one.
You need a three for Pierre, but not necessarily on the first one. But we think they'll be trying to set something up. There's a drive by Barry, counted in the foul. Well, that's a big point by Ryan Barry, her first points since quarter number one. Take a look at that play again as Barry came in for a drive. Free throw, good by Barry. 76% on the year. And there's a foul in the backcourt. Foul, by the way. Trying to pick up who that foul was on. It looked like that was on Christofferson, has just fouled out. Well, that foul was on Altenberg, the last one for Jefferson. So Christofferson is out of the game. The 5'8 senior ends their afternoon with 2 points. Huge free throws here. Good by Ashlyn Johnson, a 55% free throw shooter. That's her first point of the second half. 3-point lead. This one's the critical one. With 12.3 seconds left. Missed it. Long rebound to Williger. Chance for Pierre. Up ahead. Richter threw her fingers and out of bounds.
Why would you go there?
Johnson to Trigger. Up ahead, McGovern. And she'll be fouled.
Ufta, that was a missed opportunity there for Pierre.
So one free throw is all they need from McGovern to ice this one for Jefferson. She'll have two opportunities. Missed that one. Door is still open. Missed them both, but the long rebound to Horner, and she's fouled by Barry. So the long rebound, check that Dupree with the foul, that's her third. And Horner at the line. Got it. Second free throw, no good. And it'll end 45-41. Jefferson advances over Pierre in a hard-fought game where Pierre outscored Jefferson 14-9 in the third period of play, and they outscored Jefferson 17-11 in the fourth period of play. But some critical turnovers late in the game doomed Pierre as they fall 45-41. So it will be O'Gorman tomorrow night against Jefferson, a crosstown rivalry. And then it'll be Stevens taking on Pierre. That'll be our first consolation game tomorrow afternoon at noon Central. There you see Jefferson. They'll run to the back and put their plaque in place as they are advancing to the semifinals in a matchup with O'Gorman. What a game here today. Two games here today as we will send it over to Tony Schmidt standing by with Coach Pruitt.
Thanks, Steve. Hi, Coach Pruitt. Nice win, first of all.
Thank you very much.
So what was the key differences between this game and the last game? Obviously, earlier in the season, they came and beat you. So what was the difference here?
Yeah, Pierre is an amazing team. You know, they kind of are like looking in the mirror as far as their defensive presence and pressure. And, you know, they have some amazing players. They have Reese, They have Toiliger, they have Ryan Berry, and last time we played them, you know, they really gave us a challenge, and so we tried to throw a 1-2-2 at them today, and I think our girls did a really good job trying to make those three especially take some difficult shots, but man, they're a hell of a team, and there are some great players on that program.
Definitely. So, O'Gorman, undefeated on the season. What are we talking about going into tomorrow's game?
Yeah, I mean, O'Gorman, again, is another tough team, and they've proven that by their record. You know, right now, we're just going to enjoy this moment with our girls and then focus on what we need to do tomorrow, but we got to be ready to go. You know, we got to be up for a battle. They're going to be aggressive. They're going to be in your face, and they're undefeated for a reason. So, like I said, I'm going to let the girls enjoy tonight and then hopefully be ready to go tomorrow.
Yep. Awesome. Well, good luck tomorrow. Nice win today, Coach. Back to you, Steve.
All right, thank you, Tony. It is Jefferson winning. We'll take a timeout. Come back with more right here on SDPB3.
You live life on the move. While you determine what direction that may be, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with values. Go with friends. Go with support. Go with convenience.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small, just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business. Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth. And they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Kind of a grinded out game here in the game number two this afternoon, where Jefferson built up a big lead. They were up 24-9 at halftime. Pierre kind of clawed and scratched their way back into it. We had a chance, but threw the ball away, down by three. A free throw put it away. Let's check out these second half highlights. Dunn to the basket, getting by Terwilliger, who had to play careful with the three fouls, but then Lennox Dupree got going in the second half. She ended up with 16 on the afternoon. Pierce started hitting some outside jumpers. McGovern with the pass there, the finish by Altenberg. She ended up with 13 on the day. Terwilliger stepped outside, got that shot to go. She had 16 on the day. There was McGovern, who had a big game with 12 points. The outlet pass, the right-handed finish by Altenberg. Dupree, the nice layup there on the fast break opportunity. She came alive in the second half, 14 of her 16 points after the break. Another drive, the scoop and the layup. But at the end, Jefferson made enough free throws. As let's check out the team stats. Pierre did improve their shooting. They got up to 28% after that terrible first half where they only scored, or they only shot 17% from the floor, but three-point field goals were not falling today. Four more for Jefferson on almost as many attempts. Free throws, Pierre had a few more opportunities there, rebounding dead even. Jefferson, 22 turnovers. I'm sure Coach Pruitt's going to be talking about that.
Yes, I'm sure they'll have a discussion going into the game against O'Gorman about that. If that happens tomorrow, they're in big trouble.
Dunn with 9 points. Ashlyn Johnson with 9 points also for Jefferson. For Pierre,
They had 5 points from Barry and two each from Christofferson and from Gracelyn Taylor. So that is the individual scoring from today's game. Jefferson winning 45-41 as they hold off Pierre, who made a late rally, but it came up just a little bit short. We'll take a timeout, come back, set the stage for tonight here on SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Our teams are committed to improving quality of life in our communities. Whether we're planning construction concepts, building a new downtown development, bringing new businesses to our communities, or maintaining your apartment home. We believe everyone deserves a well-built and well-managed place to live and work. This is Lloyd.
Oh my goodness.
I decided to switch my major. I didn't want to do sports anymore, so I decided Southeast Tech would be a good one for me to go. The current instructor is a captain with the Highway Patrol. He had a lot of experience and knowledge about the job. I serve the people just as much as they serve me.
Are you nervous?
A little.
And action!
Bright things ahead, darling. Brightness and joy.
I've got plans.
Everything feels better after a cup of tea.
No, Harkin.
I just want to be right here in this moment with you.
You're going to be a bigger star than ever.
This is good news for all of us.
Best episode ever.
Our second game of the afternoon goes to Sioux Falls Jefferson. They beat Pierre 45-41. So there's our scores from earlier today. O'Gorman over Stevens in overtime, 64-58. So that sets up our first semifinal for tomorrow night, O'Gorman against Jefferson. Let's talk about what we got coming up tonight. 6 o'clock Central, 5 Mountain Time. Mitchell against Harrisburg. Then the nightcap is Brandon Valley against Spearfish. And all the action will be here on SDPB3 broadcasting. And, you know, Tony, this is our first time working together here on the air, and, yeah, you did a good job today.
Well, that's debatable, Steve, but...
Oh, no, you did fine.
Let's talk basketball, shall we?
All right, what do you see for tonight's matchups?
Well, Mitchell-Harrisburg, during the season, Mitchell won by 3. It was a tight game the whole way. Harrisburg, again, has some core players. They're going to be tough to defend, and they cause problems on offense. And Mitchell, same thing. They have some core scorers and a tough team too. I mean, it's a good matchup. So it'll be a good game.
And we look forward to having you with us tonight at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time for our evening sessions. On behalf of our crew and for Tony Schmidt, this is Steve Toombs signing off temporarily from the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls. You're watching high school basketball on SDPB3. Good afternoon, everybody.